Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host here in the Austin studios. We're going to be joining Paul Joseph Watson in London in just a few moments. We're also going to have special reports from Alex Jones. It is an amazing news day today. You know, we've been talking about these email scandals from Hillary Clinton. I thought there was a very interesting couple of revelations that have happened the last couple of days. First, we had William Binney, who's a former technical head of the NSA for many, many years, and one of the first NSA whistleblowers, telling the public that the NSA was violating the Constitution by doing dragnet surveillance on the American public. He has spoken about his concern that these leaks may not be coming from the Russians, but from people within the intelligence community. And as I mentioned when we talked about this earlier in the week, they have plenty of motivation. All of these people who take national security seriously understand that they will not be given a pass. As a matter of fact, FBI Director Comey even said that. He said, don't try this at home, essentially, after laying out the multiple felonies that Hillary Clinton had done, talking about how carelessly she had handled national security secrets. So these people understand that their future, going to jail, is on the line if they were to commit this kind of careless actions with national security. They also take it seriously. I mean, these are real secrets that she was exposing, not the kind of stuff they tried to trump up against some of the NSA whistleblowers. But now we have Judge Napolitano, who has spoken to William Binney and to other sources. And we have a video from him that we're going to play saying that the intelligence community is actually very fearful of Hillary Clinton, not just resentful of the fact that she's betrayed national security, resentful of the fact that she broke the law with multiple felonies and got away with it, but they're very afraid. As a matter of fact, he said he believes, and others in the intelligence community believe, that people lost their lives because of information that was exposed in that. So that is developing. We're also going to be talking about the attacks on Donald Trump. You know, we've had Barack Obama as well as Francois Hollande talk about how Trump is unfit. These guys are poster children for unfit presidents. I mean, it's absolutely amazing that these two guys do this. Of course, they're trying to deflect criticism away from their failed regimes. But there's another tact that we're also going to talk about, and that is something that's been developing ever since we had John Allen, a guy who has a lot in common, actually, with Hillary Clinton. You know, he has had an email scandal in his past. He's had sexual misconduct scandals in his past. He's enabled ISIS. He's got a lot to offer a Clinton administration. He'd be a great fit for them. Well, this guy who spoke at the DNC prior to Hillary Clinton is now floating the idea, along with others in the military, that Donald Trump can't be trusted with nuclear weapons. We're going to tell you why Hillary Clinton can't be trusted with the presidency beyond national security. We're going to look not only at what's going on, and we've talked a lot about Benghazi. Nobody has really talked too much. We covered it on the nightly news last night. Nobody's really talked too much, however, about why they overthrew Gaddafi in Libya. Here's a hint. It has to do with the banks. It has to do with the petrodollar. That's essentially what happened there. And we're seeing a replay of this being wound up down in Venezuela as they're going to kind of a Chairman Mao agricultural revolution. Remember when Chairman Mao drove people out of the cities and said, you know, we're all starving, so you're going to have to work in the fields. That is now happening in Venezuela, but there's a subcurrent there. There's a lot of natural resources that the globalists want to get there, just as they did in Libya, but it's beyond that as well. So we're going to talk about that as well as different aspects of the rigged election. It's being dismissed as a conspiracy theory. At the same time, they're trying to paint Donald Trump in the same way that they did Barry Goldwater. Remember that short commercial that showed a countdown, the Daisy commercial, where they had a child plucking daisies, and then they had the 10, 9, 8 in the background and a nuclear explosion. They only ran that once, but the media echoed that over and over again. As we've seen with these attacks by Khan and others, the media will do it for you. That's what they're trying to do with Donald Trump. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Paul Joseph Watson from London. We're going to be going to Paul Joseph Watson in London real quickly, an update of what we're going to be looking at later in the program. We're going to be looking in detail at rigged elections. How are they doing it in America? Of course, Donald Trump says, hey, you're going to have people here voting up to 10 times. And of course, there's no reason they can't do that if you don't have any kind of voter ID. So we're going to talk about Why he would bring that up is related, I think, to a recent North Carolina court decision. They said, are you going to need to have a photo ID? I've spoken about this before. I have direct experience in this. We used to live in North Carolina. I have a friend of my brother-in-law who actually had that happen, who went to vote. He was told that he had already voted because all you have to do is give them a name and an address. You don't have to prove your identity in any way, like you do when you cash a check at the grocery store or when you fly or when you do just about any other thing interacting with the government, especially. They always check your ID. So they don't check your ID. They said they even overturned a lower court decision as well as the will of the people in North Carolina in a recent decision by a federal court that had three judges on it. Two appointed by Obama, one by Clinton. And they said, no, this is all about racism. We can't have any ID. And so I guess maybe the Democrat National Convention shouldn't have had any picture IDs for all of us. They shouldn't have been checking our identity at each and every level as we went through the various blockades going into that venue. We're also going to talk about Paul Ryan. Or as I call him, Paul Ryan-O. He's got a primary coming up this next Tuesday. And folks, listen, if you don't like Paul Ryan's globalism, if you don't like his open borders, his support of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, this is an opportunity to get rid of the guy because this primary is an open primary, as I understand. In Wisconsin, I believe you can vote. I've looked this up on Ballotpedia. It looks, verify this if you live in Wisconsin. But if you are a Democrat, here's a way to make a really big statement about TPP. His opponent, Paul Nehlen, is very adamant that he is against TPP. He's pointed out that if Trump wins and we have a chance of shutting down the TPP, and that's the only way that we're going to shut it down. He is the only candidate that has a chance of winning who is going to shut this down. Even some of the minor candidates, like the Libertarian candidate, love it. Absolutely. They're not trying to hide their admiration for TPP. So if you want to stop this, here's a way to shut down a high-profile advocate of globalism. And at the same time, you're not really worried about the power that a new congressman is going to have. So show up in Wisconsin and vote for this. Now, I want to go to Paul Joseph Watson because, Paul, we've had Barack Obama as well as Francois Hollande in the last day talking about how unfit for office Donald Trump is. I mean, that's about the most ironic thing I can imagine to see those two losers talking about how Trump is not fit for office.
I mean, it's absolutely, man. You've got Hollande, his 90% disapproval rate. He's absolutely despised in France. He's wrecked the economy. I mean, I'm here in France now. You know, the neighbors have moved out. They've lost their business. You go to French towns, you've got businesses closing down. He's a socialist. He's wrecked the economy. Again, he's completely capitulated to terrorism. You've got his prime minister saying French citizens will just have to live with terrorism.
Yeah.
Everybody despises him. He's going to be voted out.
And, you know, you mentioned that 90%, Paul. That was back on July 5th. That was like 10 days before the massacre with a truck in Nice. And then after that, you had the priest who had his throat slit in the French church. And we were also told, as you just mentioned, that it's the new normal. Just get used to it. And then they had the revelation that he's spending $11,000 a year to get his hair done. I mean, this is like Marie Antoinette, you know, kind of levels of hypocrisy.
I mean, before we get on to Trump, let's talk about what's happening in France because you raised it. Today, you know, barely 2 weeks or a week, in fact, about 10 days since the priest was executed by Islamists in France, the day after he's buried, we've got Paris ordering the riot police to go and drag Christians out of a church in the capital of France because they want to turn it into a parking lot.
Yeah.
So they're dragging priests, they're dragging members of the congregation, they're dragging council members out of a church. That's their response to what happened last week.
That's a metaphor, isn't it? That's a metaphor for what's happening all over Europe.
You've got a firebomb bus attack that happened in Paris a week ago. And in fact, we've got the video if they want to start rolling it at some point. Muslims, again, in one of these ghetto areas, which are no-go for police, for ambulance, for firemen, they stop a bus. And I've seen this in Sweden and in other countries. They drag out these huge you know, trash recycling bins, park them in the middle of the road. The bus has to stop. Then they firebomb the bus while chanting Allah Akbar. Wow. This wasn't reported for a week. Wow. Imagine if, you know, right-wing Christians or whatever had gone out and firebombed a bus and started chanting fascist slogans or whatever. It would instantly be all over the media. This happened a week ago in France. No media coverage whatsoever. Now, I talked about this, David, on the show last night in the fourth hour. I'm here in France. You know, my mother's an English teacher. We also run a guest house. We speak to people from all over France, many of them in prominent positions in government, in corporations. You're not going to believe what one of them told me. This is somebody who works directly for a mayor in a town in France. Now, he said that this new breed of migrants that are coming in, that are being radicalized by all this ISIS propaganda on the internet, this is a new breed. I mean, they had problems with the old breed of Muslim migrants. You know, they wouldn't integrate, but generally they kept themselves to themselves. Now what's happening, according to this individual who works for the government in France, these Muslim migrants are visiting local council buildings. They're threatening local government officials that if they're not given jobs, they will kill family members of local government officials. Wow. And you say, well, that's horrific. Obviously, they must have immediately called the police, right, and reported this as a terroristic threat. No. The Muslim migrants who threatened to kill their family members if they're not given jobs were given jobs in the local council, you know, things like yard work and gardening. So they made terroristic threats to kill their family members if they weren't given jobs and were then rewarded with jobs. That's what someone from... who works for the mayor in a town in France told me.
That's just
absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
The level of capitulation that we see in France, you know, Val's saying French people have to live with terrorism. They're giving terrorists or would-be terrorists, Islamists, jobs in the local government.
And, you know, when you look at Francois Hollande and Merkel, they're not talking at all about doing anything to control immigration. I mean, that's not even in the books. You know, you've got these massive demonstrations that were held against Merkel this last weekend, 5,000 in Berlin alone, thousands in other cities. And they're holding up signs talking about how she is the queen of the tractors, is the I think it's a reference to a lot of the people that have died in these refrigerated trucks coming in, pointing out that this is not compassion. And there have been reports, Paul, about individuals who came in these waves. They were recruited. They put up these posters of Merkel in Syria and in Iraq, talking about how she is this queen of mercy, this compassionate mother. They write that actually on the signs in Arabic underneath her name. They lure these people in, and then they've talked to some of these people. Like going back to last September, they talked to one guy who came in. He was very excited and optimistic about what was going to happen. They talked to him just a couple of months ago, and he was beyond angry because he felt like he'd been betrayed. He was brought here. He was trapped, he felt. He was given about $1.50 a day to live on, living in public housing, absolutely no opportunity. So everybody on both sides of this issue are upset, and that's precisely what they want, isn't it?
Exactly. I mean, with regards to what you were saying, there's another story about an Iraqi, a self-proclaimed Iraqi. He came into Germany with this promise, as you just mentioned, of, you know, the land of milk and honey, that he would be given 2,000 euros a month, free housing, you know, a job if necessary. He came into Germany expecting that. He was told that. He arrived in Germany, found that that's not actually what he's going to get given. So he said, okay, this is terrible. I'm going to go back to Iraq. Fair enough. But no, he can't go back to Iraq because he hasn't got an Iraqi passport. So they let him into Germany with no passport. They didn't care. Now he wants to go back to Iraq and he has to wait 6 months before they process the documents to allow him to go back to Iraq. Absolutely amazing. The other thing is with the swimming pools we've seen in Germany. You know, we had a story a few days ago about these Islamists go into a swimming pool in Germany chanting Allah Akbar, threatening to exterminate the female swimmers. Well, in France, this is what I was told, which is in a way even more shocking. The way they want to deal with these Muslim migrants who are harassing women at swimming pools is, wait for it, to give them jobs as pool attendants. That's what this individual who works for the government was telling me. So they want to help these migrants integrate and make them not harass women at swimming pools by giving them jobs as lifeguards. Here's the kicker. Most of them can't swim. So not only are they harassing women at swimming pools, they're giving them jobs as lifeguards to help integrate them, and they can't swim. Absolutely astounding.
They just can't be that stupid. We have to understand that this is a deliberate clash of culture that's being engineered here. Just as the individuals in Germany, I went through and I looked at some German papers and translated them, and they were saying, who created these slick, glossy, laser-printed signs of Angela Merkel with these Arabic slogans promising people this land of plenty, telling them, come to Germany, we'll take care of you? Who did that? Who went into Syria? Who went into Iraq? Who enticed them to come in and paid for these expensive, slick posters? This is something that is being engineered. It's a clash of cultures that's being engineered. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Paul Joseph Watson, and we'll have a special report from Alex Jones coming up real soon at the bottom of the hour. We've been talking to Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to go back to him in just a moment. Before we do, I want to remind you that we have extended some of the key specials from our Sleeping Giant mega specials that we had last week, part of the 28-hour broadcast that we did beginning a week ago, last Wednesday. And going for 28 hours, we went through, and it's part of the specials that we had there. We had massive specials, but we have extended three specials on some very key items. 40% off of Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off DNA Force, and we have store-wide free shipping. Now, of course, Vitamin Mineral Fusion is our multivitamin and mineral drink mix that great tasting, great way to get a base of nutrition there. And Brain Force is one of my favorite products that I use. Brain Force is something, I would call it brain focus, because it helps me to focus if I'm tired or sleepy, if I'm on a trip. But I just use it on a regular basis. It's just good nutrition for your brain. It's if you look at the ingredients that are there, as well as DNA Force. That's one of our premium products. It's very expensive to make this. It's very difficult to manufacture it. And so it is one of our more expensive products, but very key ingredients there. If you look up BioPQQ, look at the 175 clinical studies and understand what is involved in DNA Force, as expensive as it is, as difficult to produce as it is, a 30% savings off of DNA Force is a huge saving. So again, 40% off Brain Force, 30% off DNA Force, and 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and free shipping throughout the InfoWars store. Going back to Paul, you know, Paul, we've been talking about what's going on in France and Germany with migrants. Of course, you're in France today, not in England. And we've got this story that broke on InfoWars here from UK Express, a huge brawl breaking out between asylum seekers in Germany, just typical of the many things that we see. I mean, this is not anybody being killed, but this is a kind of frustration and violence we see in the centers. And this is the clash of civilization that we've been talking about being engineered by the elite, bringing people here who have no future. They're promised a future with glossy posters in their country. They're brought here in order to get angry, frustrated, and they're not just going to take that out on each other. They're taking it out on other people. As you mentioned, you know, the ritualized killing of the priest, where the migrants are, these Muslim Islamicists are marking their territory. And then today, as you mentioned, the priest and others being drug out of this church that they're going to demolish and turn into a parking lot. I mean, that's just a metaphor for what's going on.
Well, exactly. And the video, which we've got, if they want to roll it, again, it's one of these brawls that takes place in a migrant camp, a migrant center. Again, this is in Germany. This is out of the Express. A huge punch-up between asylum seekers, including women wearing traditional Muslim garb, has been captured on video at registration center in Germany. And watch the video. Chairs are cracked overhead, punches thrown. It's absolute bedlam, but it's nothing new. There have been reports about this, you know, at these German camps for over a year now. You know, reports of fights. In fact, people who have gone to the Calais migrant camp said that this is just a routine facet of what goes on there. You've got people from different countries who, even though they're, you know, both Sunni Muslims, they still hate each other. They get embroiled in this gang, this turf warfare. You've got actual ISIS members in this camp who band together and fight and hate everybody else. So again, it's no surprise that if this is how they behave towards each other, they're going to behave similarly towards the general public. I mean, there are stories that I've read. I'm just bombarded with this every day, David. To be honest, I'm getting bored of it myself. But because the media don't report on it, we have to every time.
Yeah, the problem is fatigue, isn't it, Paul? You know, we see these stories, and now they're no longer the headline stories on Drudge. They're down in the lower levels because it's becoming so commonplace. People are starting to get accustomed to it. It's no longer big breaking news when there's a terrorist attack. They're happening virtually daily out in Europe.
I mean, the Nice one was the most shocking to me because a week after it, I suddenly realized it's only been 7 days since this massive truck attack that killed, you know, what, 84 people, and everybody's forgotten about it.
Yes.
That's the danger, and it's what Val said. You know, we're just going to have to get used to it, and it's, well, I don't want to get used to it. I don't want to live, you know, in a country on a continent where I have to fear everything, because let's remember, this is not just happening in the major cities. Some of these attacks were in rural locations. You know, this town where they killed the police wasn't a major town. It was a quiet, sleepy town where this happened. So again, you know, there's another story. I was talking about the swimming pools before. We had the Islamists shouting Allah Akbar, threatening to exterminate the women in Germany. We got another story about that, which we can hit after the break.
Yeah, we'll hit that after the break. And of course, you're talking about how it's becoming commonplace. Maybe that was why the Democrats could get away with completely ignoring the slaughter of that priest and not even talking about ISIS, mentioning the word in 61 speeches at the beginning of their convention. Stay with us. We'll be right back with a special report from Alex Jones and then more from Paul Joseph Watson in France.
On this special Wednesday edition, Paul Watson is going to be co-hosting for the first half of the transmission with David Knight, who'll complete the last 2.5 hours of this 4-hour broadcast. Again, I'm your host, Alex Jones, and I'll be sending reports in from the road today, and I'll be back live, as I always say, Lord willing, because nothing is certain in this world, tomorrow for the Thursday edition. I want to make some observations right now. Not so much about the individual stories, but what the stories together consist of and what they represent. Yesterday, Matt Bracken, former Navy SEAL, author, researcher, made a really good point that the media, the controlled globalist systems of disinformation, or the enemy media, that's what I've always called it, that's what he calls it, that's just the organic proper name, it is the enemy. It's not the dinosaur, it's not the Decepticon, it's not the sewer stream media. It's got a lot of names, we've all got names. But what it is not state-run media, but globalist, corporate-run, world government, megastate media. And about 3-4 years ago, we saw the level of propaganda go from insane to completely next level over the top, to where they are mixing disinformation with lies, truth, changing names, withholding words. This is beyond the nightmare vision that Eric Blair, a.k.a. George Orwell, envisioned in his dystopic look forward of what a world run by communists would look like in 1984. But now, what they're basically doing is just turning it all into a reality show. They call Trump someone who's involved in a reality show and who's involved in petty stuff when they are the ones that are actually doing it. Take this con character. It is one big con. It's a giant hoax. It's a giant platter of disinformation. He is Muslim Brotherhood. He does work for the Clinton law firm. It's all completely psyoped and scripted. But the trendy public still likes to have an emotional tabloid-style story where we can all feel sorry for the little guy and imply that Trump's a bully. And they continue all of this by saying, well, you know, Trump did step in it. And even libertarians and conservatives can sit back looking at the man in the arena and say, oh boy, I wish he'd watch what he does. Instead of just repudiating it all and not buying into the controversy and saying, listen, you're a Clinton operative, a Muslim Brotherhood operative, a Clinton law firm operative, and you're up there shilling for the fact that there isn't an Islamic invasion and there isn't a relationship with Hillary Clinton, with Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states, and the fact that she won't say a word about them executing gays and killing women that, you know, try to not wear a hood over their head. And that's all Trump was pointing out, is that this culture is not compatible. Had nothing to do with his son, nothing to do with gold star families. Trump said nothing about gold star families. But this is all this fractured union, this broken coalition strategy that we talk about that they're involved in so much. We were all just in some group, and oh, our group got insulted, so now we all get to hate Trump because now he's put us down, and now we're part of the group on the stage that's being given attention. It does nothing to be given attention like Black Lives Matter. It does nothing to be given attention by the gold star. All it does is train you to be patted on the head while your real freedoms are jerked out from under you. And then, of course, we've got the other controversy. Somebody's got a screaming baby, probably a plant, right up in the front, howling like it's the end of the world. And Trump's just real. He says, hey, get that screaming baby out of here. Just like when they say we're not doing the Star Spangled Banner. He says, we're doing it. Or when somebody starts a fight to distract everything, he says, take them out of here. Stop being so easy on them when somebody's punching people. That's why they're scared of Trump. He's real. They've been tapping his phones for years. They've got dossiers on him. They know that he was fighting after Afghan 25 years ago. They've got the MO on this patriot, okay? And I've talked to all the folks that have known him for decades. When I say all, I mean dozens and dozens. And I was approached by people 3, 4, 5 years ago about, you know about Donald Trump? You know he's a patriot. You know he likes the work you're doing. And I was approached by high-powered folks. I just rolled my eyes because I don't pay attention to TV shows and hotels and golf courses and casinos. I mean, quite frankly, I hadn't, you know, really followed Donald Trump. But then I got to know Trump from people that know him and obviously getting to know Trump. And that's why they're scared of him, folks. And I know I'm stating the obvious here, but if we don't support Donald Trump in the onslaught of weaponized media, next level Soviet style and beyond, we all deserve what we get. We all deserve it. The irony was not lost on a lot of folks when Planned Parenthood, within minutes of Trump saying, get that baby out of here, get that crying baby out of here, they tweeted and said, look, he's mean to babies now. Oh, and even the left said, oh my gosh, you're selling baby parts. You're not telling women that, you know, sometimes the babies are even kept alive for a while. All that's okay. You know, heat hospitals with dead babies, use baby cells to produce the flavoring testing for Pepsi. All that's okay. Engage in all of this pure evil. But oh my gosh, Donald Trump said, hey guys, get the crying baby out of here. Because it's been going on and on, distracting the entire press conference in the middle of a war, in the middle of an info war, in the middle of trying to punch through the media, in the middle of taking the entire onslaught of the globalist. Donald Trump's like, hey, get the baby out of here. It'd be like if you're flying a 747 that's about to crash and they got a baby in the cockpit crying. It'd be like, get the baby out of here. It's so refreshing. So this campaign is about a fight between globalism and nationalism, a fight between the petty mindlessness of one man dies, it's a tragedy, 10,000 die, it's a statistic. It's a fight between the elites and the globalists and against the people. And that's why you have almost all the major Republicans coming out and endorsing Hillary Clinton and piling on. That's why you've got the big Republican donors like the Koch brothers and others. We reported 6 months ago they were given hundreds of millions of dollars against Trump. And then the media said it was a conspiracy theory. Because what happens when the left hears that the arch boogeyman they were always told about, the Koch brothers, are against Trump? Then they know they've got to go for Trump. I remember hundreds of newspaper reporters over the years and others would always say, tell me about the Koch brothers, Alex. Are they financing you? And I'd say, sponsors and our listeners buying products are, I don't get any money from any political organization. Zero. And they go, oh, really? Oh, really? And I'd go, you know, I've researched the Koch brothers now. And they used to finance the Clintons. And in fact, were originally with the Clintons. And it turns out have been trying to buy off and take control of the Republican Party and not turn it into a libertarian right-wing group, a nationalist group, but turn it into what we have now. So again, this is how they operate. And so, of course, it's in the news that all these big donors, including the Kochs, are hammering Donald Trump. So to all the left, to all the Bernie Sanders people, to all the so-called conservatives, if you don't vote for Trump, shame on you, and you deserve everything that happens to you. I'm here to tell you. But I'm proud of Trump, and I'm not going to sit here when they set him up or when he, quote, stumbles. He's in a death battle with the globalist in a frickin' arena getting attacked by 500 gladiators by himself. That's the analogy. That's the allegory. And I just love everybody who, and it's still a minority of folks, but kind of buy into the hype, buy into the craze, buy into the hoax. This is a rigged system. And the only way to beat a rigged system is admitting it's rigged. The only way to stop it is to admit they've got brass knuckles under their gloves and to make them take the gloves off and show people. And Hillary's been caught in front of God and country and the whole world, screwing everybody over and stealing the stuff from Bernie Sanders, and Trump's right to expose that. In closing, here's an example of the rigged system. They were on the YouTube stage owned by Google. They officially work for YouTube, the Young Turks. That's what they've imploded down to. And when they knew they looked bad spitting and attacking and threatening me, and that whole staged melee, I still think Sink doesn't even know it was staged by some of his people. That's how just gullible he is. I think he actually believes all his leftist trap. I mean, he may be even a half-decent guy. But within an hour of us leaving, they had taken down three of our videos. I mean, it didn't say removed by user. It didn't say copyright. It just said no longer available. We made a big deal about it. They reinstated them. We called them on what happened. I think it was YouTube, not the Young Turks. And they had to back off. And it's the same thing that Trump's doing. That's just a microcosm. But it shows how they think they can just rig things from the shadows. And whether it's on the low level or the high level, whether it's on the micro level or on the gargantuan scale, as above, so below, as the ancient alchemist said, that maxim is true. And so Trump is fighting to get oxygen in the room to a dying country that's being strangled, okay? He's a doctor, basically. And he's somebody that can't stand to see the country butchered. And that's why he's risking his life and everything else. And I stand with him in the arena, and I know you do as well, InfoWarriors. But whether it's the Young Turks or whether it's this con guy or whether it's the baby thing, it's all total distractions. Hillary funds hundreds of thousands of Christians getting killed in the Middle East. It's cute and funny. And nobody humanizes the Christians. I would have brought that up more at the RNC. I mean, Trump needs to go back to all the, quote, greatest hits. And by greatest hits, there's a tendency to cover the latest scandal. No, people need to be reminded of everything in a litany. And InfoWars is going to be risking our name, our blood, our treasure as well in this fight. And I want to thank you all for your support. Now back to Paul Joseph Watson, David Knight, and the rest of the news team. There's a special report coming up later dealing with life extension technologies. It's mainstream media reporting on it, and it deals with the letter V. Now back to the live global transmission. I'm Alex Jones.
And I'm David Knight here in the Austin studios. We're talking to Paul Joseph Watson, who is on the line from France. And of course, as Alex was talking about the moves by Obama and others to just arbitrarily pronounce Donald Trump as being unfit for office, not only Obama, but also as we've been talking in the first half hour, Francois Hollande from France saying that he's unfit. And we look at the failure of these two administrations. You know, I find it interesting that where Obama was speaking, and the occasion that he was speaking, they had at the White House, they were entertaining a prime minister from Singapore. And what were they talking about? They were talking about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And nobody really paid much attention to that. Instead, it was like, oh, he said that Trump is unfit. That's just partisan politics. Nobody pays any attention to the substance. And I want to ask Paul, the pulse of people in Britain as well as in France on the TPP, but I just want to read for you what Obama said. It's essentially, he's talking about how the trade deals that he's proposing hurt everyday Americans. He said, it's absolutely true. The evidence shows that some past trade deals, not some, all of these, like NAFTA and the others, have not delivered on all the benefits that were promised, and they had some very localized costs. Well, localized, if you're talking about the United States of America, okay? We have lost billions every year. Our trade deficit shot up with NAFTA. With just Mexico alone, we had had rough trade parity until we had NAFTA passed. And then all of a sudden, our trade deficit shot up to $15 billion that first year. Has never gone below that. That was a record trade deficit that first year. This last year has been about $60 billion. So it just keeps getting larger and larger. He goes, there were communities, this is Obama, there were communities that were hurt because plants moved out. Yep. People lost jobs. Jobs were created because of those trade deals, but jobs were also lost. People who experienced those losses, those communities didn't get as much help as they needed. Look, folks, you can talk all you want to about minimum wage, but that is the effect. Lower wages and unemployment are the effect of losing manufacturing jobs. And those happen because of these trade deals. That's what nobody's talking about. Instead, they're talking about a crying baby that Donald Trump joked about. I mean, this is the kind of distraction we're seeing from the mainstream media. Paul, what is the take of people in Europe on the TTIP? Because that's, we hear typically about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but there's two trade deals that are going on to create essentially a global economy that's going to be controlled by people that aren't accountable to anyone in any of these countries.
I think there's more awareness of it in America, David. I mean, most of the people who were out on the streets protesting against the Brexit vote were siding with the likes of JP Morgan, with Goldman Sachs, with the kind of people who would back TTIP or TPP. So there's less awareness of it, but it's all about misdirection. It's exactly what you said. Nobody in the media is holding TPP front and center of the narrative. They're not talking about Hillary Clinton's role in transferring weapons to ISIS, the WikiLeaks emails.
Yeah.
They're talking about this. Trump backer busted for battering wife. This is one of the top stories right now. A 78-year-old man basically had an argument with his wife over Donald Trump and assaulted her. David, I wrote a story last week about a black Vietnam veteran who was shot in the leg because he expressed his support for Donald Trump at a bar. Again, local news story, didn't get any nationwide play whatsoever. We see Trump supporters being attacked over and over again, yet what do they choose to put front and center? One example of a 78-year-old guy beating his wife. It's all about misdirection. These Trump scandals, again, oh, Trump tried to kick a baby out of his convention. Absolute BS. He made a joke, which is actually quite funny if you read it, about a crying baby interrupting his speech. Suddenly, that's a huge scandal showing how evil and emotionless Donald Trump is. Meanwhile, Hillary Clinton is literally a sociopath, all the experts say, which we'll get onto later. And then the other scandal, this is out of Mick.com. At Donald Trump rally in Virginia, boy screams, "Take the bitch down," again, in reference to Hillary Clinton. That's the major shocking scandal, that somebody said bitch at a Donald Trump rally. Again, it's all about misdirection. They're not talking about the key issues, which we can delve further into after the break, which has to be not Kazia Khan, Hillary Clinton's role in arming ISIS. You know, there's the big scandal because Trump hurt the feelings of this Muslim family. Meanwhile, Hillary is embroiled in helping to transfer weapons to ISIS, which killed 100,000 Muslims over the past 2 years. Which story is the mainstream media talking about? They're talking about Trump offending somebody.
And of course, John Allen, who she had speaking for her, was also involved in fighting ISIS. He was a special envoy from Obama to fight ISIS, but he was part of building up ISIS as well. And Paul, when you're talking about these emails that have been released, I think it's very important because we've been reporting on this. Others have been reporting on it for 5 years. We knew what was going on in Libya, even a year before Benghazi. Remember, the revolution started there. We talked about the origins of it and everything, but it's these documents. When the documents come out, it's a very powerful thing, just like it was a very powerful thing when Snowden released the documents that NSA whistleblowers had been talking about for, I guess it was about 11 years or 12 years. Stay with us. When we come back, we've got another special report from Alex Jones, and we'll be talking more to Paul Joseph Watson from France. We'll be right back.
Fight against the New World Order. I want to thank David Knight, of course, Paul Watson, for the job they've done. I just want to encourage Paul Watson. His family owns a small hotel in a rural area of France to write a report about what these government officials have been telling him. and to expose what's happening. Because from my research of what Islamists do in each other's countries, once they invade them, and once they get a high enough number through migration or whatever the case may be, is they are allowed, because again, we're called demis. Once they start occupying us, we're like subhumans. They're allowed to tax us at a much higher rate. They're allowed to kill us. They're allowed to do whatever under their system. They start going to people's houses and saying, you're a Catholic priest, you're a Christian, you've got to give me money or I'm going to kill you. A Catholic priest doesn't do it, so he gets stabbed. That just happened this week. It's happening in Sweden, it's happening in France, it's happening in Germany. And so Paul was talking about how the Muslims, this new wave, well, this is what they do once they get up to 5-10%. This new wave shows up and says, put me in positions of power in your government, and I will pay you off. That's what the higher level rich ones do. At the low level, though, they come up and say, give me jobs, give me pay, or I will kill you. And it's the fact that they're willing to kill themselves or kill others that gives them so much power. And as Paul Watson reported, they submit to it. They give in to it. And this is the culture of appeasement. And this is laissez-faire and the West that has become so decadent that it doesn't have a will to fight. And when you pay off a pirate once, he's going to come back. When you pay off the kidnapper once, he's going to come back. And this is the mark of third world countries. It's the mark of failed nations. It's the mark of cultures that start giving in, and then all credibility drops, all stability drops, and your society goes into a black hole. And this is what's happening. In Europe, in Sweden, in the Netherlands, you name it, we have the reports where if someone is robbed at their home by gunpoint or even stabbed, and then they fight back, they're thrown in jail for 2 years, 5 years, and the attackers are thrown in jail for 6 months, and then you have to pay them hundreds of thousands of euros, in some cases tens of thousands. I mean, you can pull these cases up. I see these every few days where they throw the book at you for defending yourself because it's a parasite class on top that identifies with a lower parasite criminal class. The problem is that the parasite class only wants another year or two in the scheme of things to rob people. They're willing to move to another country that they haven't infected yet. Like locusts, it's like Californians or the people that have moved to California that have destroyed it in the last 50 years, now coming to Texas and colonizing us and setting up the very same systems of high taxes, regulations, and corruption. This is their formula. This is their formulae. Now, the low-level folks are just useful idiots that don't know. But this is a parasite predator system, and men need to stand up and stop submitting and stop giving in. Now is the time to say no. That concludes this global transmission. Infowars.com is the tip of the spear. The New World Order is doing everything they can to shut this down. Realize that when you spread the links, the videos, the articles, you are engaged in information warfare against the enemy. They have lies. We have the truth. They have deception and dishonor. We have honor. They have the devil. We have Christ. We will win. Now, again, the restreams are coming back up. The stations across the country where the broadcast. Nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock Central. This is an info war. You're in the middle of it. There's a war on for your mind. God bless you all. And, of course, there's one more important point that needs to be added to this. A nation of cowards will be ruled by slave masters. A nation of sheep will be ruled by wolves. It's common sense. If someone ever to my face threatens to kill my family, that's a threat of bodily injury and harm, and I'm going to take immediate action myself with my bare hands. And that's not some macho statement. That's civilization. I'm loving, I'm caring, I'm compassionate, and I will not be terrorized, and I will not be bullied, and I'll never give in to blackmail. I'll never give in to threats, and that goes to all my enemies out there, and you know who you are. You will burn in hell, filth. The weak scum for too long has had its way, and I don't just mean jihadis. All of you know who you are. You're the cowards. And I'm telling you, the response to your pushing fear is for good men to stand up to you, and we are. We're only affecting the battle space now with information warfare. You will fall, so get ready for it. You may intimidate all the evil, corrupt, filth.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight here in the studios in Austin. Joining us from France is Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to have some more special reports from Alex Jones coming up. I want to talk to Paul about this Wrath of Khan, is what I like to call it. Everybody has been furious about the back and forth between Khazer Khan. They believe that he was disrespected because he attacked Donald Trump ad hominem, and Donald Trump responded in kind. The reality is this, folks, as we've now learned, and we've got a couple of reports up on Infowars.com. He held up the Constitution. He held up his pocket Constitution. They say, well, you know, that became a bestseller on Amazon for a day or so. Let's hope some of the Democrat liberals actually read that and understand how there is no right to immigration in the Constitution and how the Constitution is the antithesis of what this man has done his entire life. We now see that he has taken down the website that shows that he is specialized in immigration visas for people who are coming from Saudi Arabia and from other countries. And this is something that has been questioned by Homeland Security, saying that this is a security issue, these types of immigration visas. There's been a lot of talk about this for several months before we knew that he was had a law firm that specialized in this. But more so than that, we also have an article that shows what he believes about Sharia law. Of course, he has written and books on it. He has written treatises on it. He held there was a seminar that he had a book review of. It was called Human Rights in Islam. Let's talk about what human rights in Islam are under Sharia law, of course. It allows men to beat their wives. It allows them to humiliate people who violate Islamic law. It allows them to execute gays, prostitutes, blasphemers, Muslim apostates. And then there's this relationship that Wayne Madsen has discovered that's up on an Infowars.com report, what the media isn't reporting about Khazir Khan. And in that, he goes back and looks at his long history. He says, look, you know, he came in the United States in 1980 from Dubai, but he'd gotten his college degree in Pakistan. And he was working on international trade law for Saudi Arabia and Pakistan. He co-founded the Journal of Contemporary Issues and Muslim Law, periodical that seeks to defend Sharia law, give the basis for it. And then he also points out, as Wayne Madsen always does, the links to Huma Abedin. Okay, who has close links to the Muslim Brotherhood through her mother. Her mother still lives in Saudi Arabia and teaches there. Of course, the Wahhabist Islam that is being taught by them. And of course, you know, you have Valerie Jarrett. She was born in Iran, grew up there. There are a lot of Muslim ties in the Obama administration. And then he has this interesting tidbit. He finds that even though Pakistan was not a member of the U.S. coalition in Iraq, the Pakistani embassy's ISI chief, that's their intelligence service, attended the funeral of Khan's son, Captain Khan, in Arlington Cemetery. And he asks, was Khan working through his Saudi and Pakistani-connected father with the ISI? What kind of deep connections? We're told that this guy spoke simply because they had seen an editorial that he had written somewhere. And they said, oh, that's a great op-ed piece. Would you come and speak at our convention? No. Perhaps there are ties that run much deeper than this. We certainly know there are deep ties with Huma Abedin, with Valerie Jarrett, and with Obama to the Muslim community. And, of course, those ties are shared by Hillary Clinton. Your comments, Paul.
Well, you talk about Sharia law. Obviously, we've only got a minute left, so we'll get more into this and Hillary Clinton after the break. You mentioned Pakistan. Of course, Pakistan, we just had the case where the British, the woman who was living in Britain, went over to Pakistan to visit relatives. She was strangled to death because her family disagreed with who she had married back in Britain. Of course, that's an honor killing, again, part of Sharia law. But this Khazir Khan thing, it's a setup, it's a hatchet job. And we'll talk more about it after the break and how it ties into Hillary Clinton.
That's right. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with Paul Joseph Watson from France. More reports from Alex Jones. I'm David Knight in the Austin studios. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, August 3rd, 2016. I'm David Knight in the Austin studios. We're talking to Paul Joseph Watson from France. In the he's not from France. He's actually from the U.K. He's in France today. But Paul is from the U.K., of course, our editor here at Infowars.com. We were talking in the last break about Khazir Khan and the controversies that have erupted. And, of course, as you've heard our news break from Leanne McAdoo pointing out the contrast between Sharia law that he believes the Constitution should be subordinated to. And if you don't understand what Sharia law is, you don't understand the lies that are told by the Islamicists. I mean, for example, here's one of the articles. This is from Breitbart. It's on Infowars.com. They say, in 1983, Khan wrote a glowing review of a book compiled from a seminar held in Kuwait called Human Rights in Islam. Okay, and the guy who wrote this is a pro-jihadi Islamicist lawyer, just like Khan, okay, who is the father of the Taliban movement. Okay, and what are human rights in Islam? Well, that means that you can beat your wives, you can kill gays, prostitutes, blasphemers, and Muslim apostates, and you subordinate everything to Muhammad's writings. And of course, we've seen multiple evidence of this from Khazir Khan. Now, he had a website that showed what he was doing here in the United States. He was exploiting a loophole that has been exploited by Fethullah Gulen, and that is the EB-5 visa program that allows people it's been used by a lot of corrupt individuals, especially within the Middle East. As they point out in this article, Senator Grassley exposed it back in February 2016. He said the enforcement arm of Homeland Security wrote an internal memo that raises significant concerns about this program, the EB-5 visa program. One section of the memo outlines concerns that it could be used by Iranian operatives to infiltrate the United States. But, of course, it is also being used, as this lawyer Khan is using it, to get wealthy individuals, allow them to buy their way into the United States. But, of course, terrorist organizations can buy their way into the United States as well. Thirdly, we have this other article that's on Infowars.com from Wade Madsen. And Wayne Madsen goes back and looks at the connections, the possible connections to ISI, to the intelligence service in Pakistan. Remember that it was out of Pakistan that they began the operations to fight the Mujahideen, arm the Mujahideen to fight the Russians. That turned into Al-Qaeda. So, Paul, tell us your take. You were just starting to talk about Khan. Tell us your take on where this is all heading.
Well, they obviously put him up there at the DNC to try and once again frame Donald Trump as a racist, Islamophobic bigot. You know, he attacked Donald Trump. His son died in Iraq. Again, this was before all the Islamicist and all the, you know, Sharia law questions came out. But they put him up there as a hatchet job. It was staged. It was planned well in advance. The irony is he's supporting a candidate in Hillary Clinton whose policy directly led to the deaths of at least 100,000 Muslims over the past 2 years. She supported the attack on Libya. Let's not even mention the fact that she voted for, you know, Iraq. What, 200,000 dead Muslims at least from that war? Trump opposed it. She supported the war on Libya, the attack on Libya to overthrow a secular leader, Gaddafi, who was fighting against Islamists. Okay, when he fell, you know, we came, we saw, he died. She celebrated it, laughed about it. When that happened, the national armory of Libya was looted, and hundreds of tons of weapons were transferred from Libya to Syria because the Obama administration was supporting jihadist rebels in Syria who went on to form groups that became ISIS. So she, her support for that policy directly led to the rise of ISIS, directly led to those weapons transfers, directly led to the slaughter of at least tens of thousands, if not 100,000 Muslims. So they've put this guy up there to say that Donald Trump hates Muslims. That's the implication. Meanwhile, he's supporting a candidate whose policies led to the death of 100,000 Muslims. And now you see this out of the New York Times. Ignoring advice, Donald Trump presses attack on Khan family and GOP leaders. So they basically try to make out that even Trump's own advisors are saying that he should just apologize and move on. Basically, Trump's stood up for himself. This attack came out of nowhere. And now they're saying, oh, even his advisors are abandoning him. What a horrible, you know, scandal. Meanwhile, Julian Assange is out there. Again, they're completely ignoring this, saying that these emails, these WikiLeaks DNC emails and the other ones that they released and that they're about to release, prove that Hillary Clinton helped transfer weapons to ISIS. No attention on that whatsoever. Also, these emails reveal that a company called Lafarge, which we were talking about France and Paris earlier, ironically, the government in Paris is working with this company, Lafarge, which is buying oil from ISIS, which is sending money directly to ISIS in Syria, which is working with ISIS in Syria to ensure the safe passage of its employees. Now, who do you think Lafarge, this company, is a regular donor to? Well, imagine my shock. It's the Clinton Foundation. So you have tie after tie after tie with Hillary Clinton transferring weapons to ISIS, taking money from companies that do business with ISIS, again, that led to the slaughter of tens of thousands of Muslims. But no, Donald Trump's rhetoric is what's evil. That's Islamophobic. That's racist. No attention whatsoever from the media on these emails, which reveal Hillary's complicity in supporting the rise of ISIS, which continues to this day.
You know, Paul, one of the other things that came out in these emails, I think, is very alarming. We've had a lot made out of Black Lives Matter, haven't we? And yet, here's Hillary Clinton, who it's revealed in these emails at the time, they knew there was a genocide going on in Libya because Gaddafi had allied himself with the sub-Saharan Africans. And so they identified anybody as being allied with Gaddafi if they were black. They were being shot on sight. There were massive atrocities. Entire towns were wiped out. One town, 10,000 people eradicated. So there was this black genocide that was going on. And she was warned about this beforehand in the emails and did absolutely nothing for it. But of course, she cares about black lives. She thinks they matter. Not in Libya.
Oh, no. We carried the stories immediately afterwards. They were taking these black Libyans, putting them in concentration camps and torturing them. And bear in mind, go back to that situation in 2011, the media was celebrating this as some great liberation. The dictator has fell. And yes, Gaddafi wasn't great. But like Saddam Hussein, he was fighting against the Islamists. Look at what happened to Iraq after they got rid of Saddam Hussein. Again, complete quagmire, complete nightmare, terrorist attacks still every week. Nobody even pays attention. You know, 200 dead in Iraq suicide bombing. Nobody even cares anymore because it's so regular. Again, that is laid at the feet of Hillary Clinton. She voted for the Iraq war. She pushed this policy to overthrow Gaddafi. It led to the arming of jihadists, the rise of ISIS, and as you said, the torture and displacement of thousands of black Libyans. But yeah, she's a big champion of Black Lives Matter.
And of course, the interesting part about that too, as you point out, we were talking about that when it happened 5 years ago. It was common knowledge. Everybody was pointing to this genocide. But she was informed that it was happening even before the mainstream media began doing it. So they knew that it was happening. They created the climate that caused that to happen, and they allowed it to continue to happen. I guess like Madeleine Albright, she thought it was worth it. You know, when they asked Madeleine Albright if the blockades were worth the lives of 500,000 children, she'd say, yeah, it was worth it. So I guess Hillary Clinton thought the black lives were worth it for her policy. And you know the other thing, Paul, that we saw from the emails that were released, we saw an analysis by Sidney Blumenthal about the French motivation to go in there, as well as Hillary Clinton's motivation, was to try to stop the currency that was going to go into competition with the fiat currencies of the central banks. You know, Gaddafi had set up a gold and silver backed currency, you know, kind of like our Constitution, that would have gone into competition with our fiat currency that was backed on petrodollars, because he was going to value his vast quantities of oil into that. And they were going to create a pan-African new currency that was going to go in competition with a petrodollar. That was a key reason for the central banks, of course, why that was done.
Precisely. I mean, there were multiple reasons. Remember at the time, the left celebrated it as this humanitarian venture, complete catastrophe. Obama comes out today and says, oh, we didn't plan properly for the aftermath. Yeah, really? Do you think so? Absolute quagmire. You've got hundreds of people trying to get in boats to come from Libya to Italy, drowning every single week. Again, every one of those deaths is on Hillary Clinton's head. They're mostly Muslims, predominantly black Muslims, but you know, Donald Trump is evil. The other thing about Hillary, because we've only got about a minute left here, I've been talking to mental health experts. You've seen all the videos that we've posted about her bizarre behavior, her apparent seizures. Well, obviously she had this collapse in 2012. She had the blood clot on her brain. So I've been talking to mental health experts about that. And you mentioned earlier Obama saying, you know, Trump is unfit to be president. Hillary Clinton may be physically unfit to be president. There's a massive cover-up regarding both her health, a dire health situation, and her personality disorder, which may be causing some of these bizarre seizures. So I'm going to do a video on that, which is probably coming out tomorrow. So watch out for that.
Okay, and also then Kane, who is a full-on globalist and open borders, open trade, then would be the one to step into her place. That's something that the people who previously supported Bernie Sanders need to consider very carefully. And when we're looking at other globalists to get rid of, don't forget, the countdown is on. Next Tuesday is a primary for Paul Ryano, the guy who is going to be the biggest opposition to a President Trump in support of open borders and these trade deals. And it is an open primary, Democrats. You can vote against Paul Ryan coming up next Tuesday. Stay with us. In the next section, we're going to have a special report from Alex Jones. We'll be right back.
Alex Jones reporting from the road. I wanted to add an addendum to the report I filed earlier about the con hoax and the Purple Heart hoax and the baby hoax and all the rest of it. Look at the Purple Heart issue now with con attacking Trump, this Clinton operative, this Muslim Brotherhood operative. Think about it. Someone at a rally tries to give him a Purple Heart, not like he received a Purple Heart, not claiming he was ever wounded in the military, and it turns into a national issue of Donald Trump's a draft dodger. When you've got all these neocons that were draft dodgers, Donald Trump isn't, who pushed the Iraq war and all the rest of it, it's just too rich. They take his greatest strengths and they turn it into weaknesses, and the public buys into it. They are attacking his base because they know how strong he is as a nationalist and how strong he is with our military. That's what this comes down to. And Trump needs to respond directly and not just say they're lying media, but on each point say, because he is the pundit that can break through and punch through, see how they do this. They know I'm strong in the military. So they come in and have somebody hand me this Purple Heart. When you're walking through a crowd, folks, I have to have somebody behind me just to hand all the stuff people give me, the books, the trinkets, it's something personal and special they want to do. And by the way, if you don't think Donald Trump deserves a medal for all the danger he's under and the hundreds of millions of dollars he's lost with all the boycotts and the $70 million he spent of his own money, give me a break. Again, they know he's a hero. They know he's the archetype of that. So that's why they engage in that. But I want to speak briefly, and then I'm going to hand it back to Paul Watson and David Knight, to the fact that this is how the hoax works on libertarians and patriots and conservatives. They want us all to be armchair strategists and quarterbacks, which is fine. But then we can't buy into thinking we're better than Trump and getting on the bandwagon and adding energy to it when we think he makes a mistake. Like saying, oh boy, he really stepped in it, or oh boy, he really screwed up. Yeah, going after that con guy. We love Trump because he's off the cuff. He's real. He's not reading from a teleprompter. He's not controlled. He's a nationalist. That's why they hate him. That's why they're doing this. That's why they're engaging in these activities. And so, again, that's how the mind game works, tricking us to feel like we're official, feeling like we're powerful to be part of the system. And that's how the brainwashing works. And we have to absolutely break through it and be aware of it. We have to know how these systems operate and be aware of the tricks, or we'll fall for it every time. This is enticing us to feel like we're at the table, to feel like we're part of the analysis, to feel like that, you know, we're in the system now, and oh, we're in on the bringing down Trump, and you know, we're in on the fact that you know, we're looking down on him. This is the stuff of slaves. This is the stuff of pathetic hordes of rabble that are manipulated and controlled. So be aware of it. If he starts making mistakes on policy, if he starts flip-flopping on real issues, if he starts not standing up for our republic and standing up for our sovereignty and standing up for our trade, and if he stops standing up against globalism, then we go after Trump. We don't go after him with all these faux made-up things that the enemy puts out, even if it's legitimate sometimes, which it isn't, very, very rarely. It doesn't matter. We're buying into their bandwagon, buying into their propaganda, and it's amateur and it's pathetic, and people should see through it. All right, back to the reporters.
All right, and that's Alex Jones. And, of course, the next segment, we're going to have a special report from Alex Jones about top billionaires and how they're into drinking blood. Yeah, that's right, folks, drinking blood. Alex is going to have that special report coming up in the next segment. You don't have to drink blood in order to take care of your health, however, and we really do appreciate your support of our operation when we bring you good products. So we don't sell blood for you to drink to extend your life. No, we have some real things that are really going to help you. And we have extended those specials as part of our Sleeping Giant mega special that we did last Wednesday. We had that 28-hour broadcast offering specials. We have extended three of those items, and we have added store-wide free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com. Those three items are 30% off DNA Force And this is real stuff, folks. You can look up the studies yourself. Go to the site, look at the descriptions of the products, look at the ingredients in there, look at the reviews. We have third-party reviews. We have people who get the products are allowed to put in reviews. You can see the hundreds of five-star reviews for these products, see what people say it has done for them. But, of course, with DNA Force, you can read what BioPQQ does for you. There's 175 clinical studies. Find out about that. It is 30% off for DNA Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion drink, and that is our drink mix that has a multivitamin, multi-mineral supplement that gives you a good baseline of healthy nutrients that you need for your health. You can get that at 30% off as well, and 40% off Brain Force. Free store-wide shipping at InfoWarsStore.com, and those three products have been extended. Go to InfoWarsStore.com. We thank you for your support, and that's why we've extended these sales a little bit longer. I don't know how much longer they're going to last. It's not going to go for very long. We'll be right back with Alex Jones talking about what billionaires do, thinking they're going to help extend their life. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight here in the Austin studio. We've got a special report from Alex. Why Twitter thinks Peter Thiel is a vampire. There's a process called parabiosis where they take blood from young people, they inject it into older people, think it's going to rejuvenate their tissue so they can live forever. Sounds kind of like an old Dracula flick, you know, from Hammer films, doesn't it? But actually, there is a long history of elites who are obsessed with blood and using it this way. So here's this report from Alex. He reveals who the biggest vampires on the planet really are.
Is the sun in the future of humanity rising, or is it setting? Has the age of the vampire arrived, or is the age of the parasitic blood drinker falling? Will we continue to allow our souls to be held captive by the globalist system, or will we break free?
The secret to reversing some effects of aging might be in the blood of the young.
Three new studies have found that blood from young mice can reverse symptoms of aging in older mice.
Three studies will be published this week in the journal Science and Nature, each exploring the regenerative properties of young blood.
The blood of the young can make the old young again. Are you kidding me? It sounds like out of a sci-fi movie or something.
So what is it in the blood? Do we know?
Peter Thiel here, a member of the PayPal Mafia, it's called. He's 48 years old, yet plans to live forever,
forever, forever, forever,
forever. The process is called parabiosis. And there's a company called Ambrosia that is openly raising money to bring it to market. Libertarian billionaire Peter Thiel, who was the star of the Republican National Convention for coming out as being gay, he's also a fan of blood transfusions. Parabiosis is a process of taking a young person's blood and putting it into your veins, into your cardiovascular system to rejuvenate your body with the essence of the young. What it really is modern vampirism. Now, I want to be clear. I don't think Peter is a bad person just because he's attended Bilderberg meeting. I don't think he's a bad person just because he's into the science of blood transfusion. My concern, though, is with the larger cultural movement to see human beings and human fluids as nothing more than commodities. Now, the mainstream media is selling the idea that this technique, parabiosis, is the fountain of youth, and that Peter is the first person to really push it. Actually, if you read it in the press, the Queen Mother, for more than 30 years before she died, was getting sometimes entire whole body blood transfusions. It's been reported that Queen Elizabeth II also gets them, as well as Prince Charles. But where the story really gets weird is that Prince Charles came out in the last decade and said, "I'm a direct descendant of Vlad the Impaler," who was, of course, the Hungarian or Romanian Count Dracula of history that opposed the Muslim invasion.
The genealogy shows that I'm descended from Vlad the Impaler, you see. So I do have a bit of a stake in the country.
As it were.
I remember almost 20 years ago interviewing the author of Bloodlines, the Illuminati, Fritz Springmeier. And he was talking about the fact that Prince Charles and the royal family of England trace their lines back to Vlad the Impaler. I thought he was a kook. I thought he was a liar. Then a few years later, they were in the British news admitting that and saying that Prince Charles was obsessed with Dracula. Then they started digging up dead bodies on the royal family's palaces and that of children. And then Jimmy Savile, who was highly connected to the royal family, was basically caught with all these dungeons and torture centers. And it had turned out that he was a Satanist who was abusing children through the Children's Charity, and that the BBC had been running it and was basically protecting all of it. Then it made more and more sense. And then I began to research even more and found out that the people running things aren't physical, immortal vampires, but they have the spirit of what you describe as a vampire, and they believe their god Lucifer, if they establish a world government, is going to give them eternal life. And now they're mainlining the idea of baby parts and blood from the young to make the rich live longer. The Mayans and the Aztec culture that came out of it sold the body parts of those that were sacrificed to the gods. They themselves funded their priesthood on the sale of human meat. When we talk about the legend of vampires, we have to understand that every culture has this because there's always been psychopaths and other groups of individuals who have joined forces and created central governments to actually carry out the practice of bloodletting, bloodlust, human sacrifice. And that the legend of blood-drinking vampires has its roots in real activity that's taken place in every century, in every millennium, and in every culture. Now, to be clear, from our deep research, we don't believe that actual semi or totally immortal vampires exist. But the spirit of parasitic evil does exist and has been manifested through what we would call satanic bloodlines in every culture throughout history. And we see, again, establishment media pushing the idea of women eating babies' placentas at birth and Kim Kardashian doing blood facials. The idea that if we take something from some other human, we ourselves get something. This is the psychopaths setting up a system where they're the Morlocks from H.G. Wells and we are the subboid Eloys, the innocents who are being fed on. We have a predator class establishing a system where the general public is the prey. Now, the king of the vampires in all of world history is the Communist Chinese. The Communist Chinese kill between 65 and 84 million people, according to their own annals, just during Mao Zedong's communist rule. And to this day, hundreds of thousands of political dissidents a year who've committed no crimes are grabbed, put in prison, blood typed, prepared, and then rich Westerners fly into Japan just an hour away. Then the prisoner is taken. They are gutted in a mobile execution van on the tarmac. The fresh organs are loaded on ice, flown to Tokyo and other Japanese cities where the organs are implanted in rich Asians, Westerners, and others. This is true vampire activity, where you murder a Buddhist or some other person for their religious or political activity and then steal their organs, make money off of it, and implant it in decadent slobs that paid for the luxury. The truth is, all of us have a little bit of vampire in us. All of us can be predators. All of us cannot have empathy for our fellow humans and dehumanize them. It's very easy to see the dumbed down public, if you're intelligent, and decide to not try to help them, but to just let them be ignorant and basically capitalize on the fact that they're unaware of what's happening around them. But all of us must transcend this because you reap what you sow. What comes around goes around. Call it karma. We as a species must face the light. We must look into the sun and not hide in the darkness. We must come together and realize that the elite know that there are very serious developments in life extension technology and have openly said they want a world government in control so the general public doesn't have access to this. There are a lot of clean, healthy, safe ways to extend our lives, and the establishment knows this. The fountain of youth won't be found in the blood of babies or virgins. We know that Satanists, on record, have been involved inside abortuaries conducting ceremonies. We know that children for thousands of years have been tortured so that they release hormones in their blood so that initiates can have these powerful religious experiences. That's why it's important to understand that humanity is not a commodity, that humanity is made in the image of God, and that we face absolute judgment when we attack the human genetic code and also the genetic code of this planet, because it was made by the Creator. The archetypes are clear. Legend points the way to not just the past, the present, but the future. The vampire operates in the dark, in the occult, in the secret, in the hidden. The liberty lover operates in the light. You will decide the future of humanity. You will decide if the sun is rising or if the sun is setting. We will decide whether the age of vampires is now dawning upon us or whether the age of vampires is now ending.
All right, and that was Alex Jones, and he's going to have more special reports for us later in this broadcast. I'm David Knight here in the Austin studio. Now, as reported on Monday, we had William Binney, former technical head of the NSA, this weekend go on radio with the Aaron Klein Show. Of course, we've interviewed William Binney multiple times on the Alex Jones Show as well. He was one of the first whistleblowers to talk about how the NSA was using 9/11 to do dragnet surveillance in violation of the Constitution. They tried to put Thomas Drake in jail for 35 years for possession of four documents, none of which were classified. One of them they classified that day. Another one they said, hey, it's not classified, but you should have known it. They were not anything that should have ever been classified at any level. But, of course, he's going to be on with us this Friday as well. We're going to talk to him. There's a lot of news that is breaking in terms of who are behind these emails. You know, when Donald Trump joked and said, hey, Russia, if you got the emails, we need to know what's in them, because Hillary Clinton was allowed to destroy 30,000 emails before she had to hand over her servers to the FBI for investigation. That was a privilege that was not afforded to Deutsch, who was a CIA director under her husband, Bill Clinton, who had classified documents on his unsecured laptop, who lost his security clearance, who was facing jail term before he was pardoned by Bill Clinton. William Binney said on this interview on Sunday, he said that, look, Mueller has said that they've got this information. So he said, it's not the Russians that have it. The FBI's got this information. They could put that information out there at some point. And then he went on to say this. He said, the other point is that Hillary, according to an article published by The Observer in March of this year, has a problem with the NSA because she's compromised gamma material. What is gamma material? Binney said, that's the most sensitive material at the NSA. So there's a number of NSA officials who are complaining to the press, to the people who wrote the article, that she did that, that she lifted material that was in her emails directly out of gamma reports. These are the things that we've talked about in the past that are above top secret, things that are born secret. In other words, conversations with foreign leaders, analysis of intercepted conversation between two different foreign leaders. That type of highest level security is born classified. That's the gamma compartment within the NSA, and that was also compromised. Now, we just had an interview that was aired on Fox News. They were talking to Judge Napolitano, and he had this to say about what other people in the intelligence community were concerned about with these leaks.
One of the reasons there was so much anxiety about Mrs. Clinton from the intelligence community is the belief that some of the materials that she handled with such extreme carelessness, I'm using Jim Comey's phrase, in my opinion, it was criminal, but in the FBI director's opinion, it was extreme carelessness, contained the names of American undercover intelligence agents, some of whom are no longer with us. This is the belief of a lot of people in the intelligence community. If Mrs. Clinton does become president of the United States, she's going to have a lot of antipathy towards her by people in the intelligence community. This is the tip of the iceberg.
That wasn't in the report, that people might have died because names were listed and sent, right?
Correct. The FBI did not reveal that. The FBI never revealed the contents, and quite properly, because it's still still classified.
Sure.
The FBI never revealed the contents of the 25 top secret, of which five were SAP, meaning even FBI agents didn't have the clearance to reveal them. So Bill Binney is saying of the 60,000 NSA agents and contractors, there's a critical mass who fear Mrs. Clinton's presidency, right, and more likely than not hacked into the DNC and
NSA
leaked this.
Think about that for a moment. Think about that. Judge Napolitano said, and he was quoting William Binney and others, there's 60,000 people within the intelligence community. There's a critical mass. It only takes one disgruntled employee to put this stuff out there. And not just disgruntled, not just angry that she violated the religion of the national security state. And there's some real reasons to have real secrets. I mean, what they're doing with dragnet surveillance of the American people is not in our national security interests. It's a violation of our civil liberties. It's a violation of everything this country was built upon. But there are some things that need to be kept secret. These people who are keepers of those secrets, who are legitimate in that regard, are very concerned about her betrayal of that. They're very angry that she got away with that. Other people don't get away with that. But even more than that, they're very concerned for their lives. Think about the fact that we just recently had a massive hack of pretty much all the federal employment records. We've had 700 soldiers whose information has been hacked, and that's been turned over, that's been intercepted by ISIS, okay? They're going to use that to possibly attack American soldiers. Who knows what they're going to do with that? But these are people who are in highly secret, classified, vulnerable positions that, as Judge Napolitano said, people within the intelligence community told him they are no longer with us. In other words, they believe they were killed because of Hillary Clinton's violations of these national security secrets of the protocol. So any of these people within the NSA, they have the technical capability to do this. They have far more motivation to protect us from somebody like Hillary Clinton than the Russians do. The Russians would probably, unless they believed, as is a good possibility, that Hillary Clinton is going to escalate this into a nuclear war. I find it very ironic that now Joe Scarborough and other people are trying to float out this phony narrative about Donald Trump like they did about Goldwater in that LBJ commercial, okay? They're trying to paint him as somebody who is trigger-happy with nukes. You want to know who's trigger-happy with nukes? It's people like Victoria Nuland in the U.S. State Department and the Obama administration, the people who tried and successfully did ramp up the Cold War again. We have a neo-Cold War. We don't want to go and make it a hot war, and yet we have these people like I talked to at the Democrat National Convention, lobbyists, essentially, activist groups for the Ukraine, saying, look, we need to put in lethal weapons. We need to send that to the Ukraine. We need to do everything. We need to get ourselves involved in the Ukraine. Something's been part of Russia longer than we have had our independence from Great Britain. The Crimea has been part of Russia going back to the 1760s. We don't need to get involved there. We don't need to go right up to their doorstep. What do you think Obama would do if Russia were to come in here and try to help Texas get free from the chains of Washington? They would not take kindly to that, okay? And the same people that I was talking to absolutely disregarded any concern about the fact that this would escalate not only into a new Cold War, but into a nuclear war. And there were people in the Republican Party as well. The globalists in the Republican Party were furious that the Trump people shut down that provocative language. If you want to know who's provocative, look at who took down that provocative language in the Republican platform. It was the Trump people. He's not sitting there with his finger on the button, but Hillary Clinton is throwing this information. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We just had that special report in the last segment, why Twitter thinks that prominent billionaire may be a vampire. You know, you don't have to drink other people's blood to improve your health. We have a lot of clean, safe products that we sell. It helps to fund our operation. And of course, we had a large sale last Wednesday, 28-hour sale, and we still have three items that we have carried over from that sale. 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion. That is a drink mix, great tasting drink mix that gives you a broad base nutrients of vitamins and minerals. And then 30% off DNA Force. You can find all of those at InfoWarsStore.com. And there is store-wide free shipping on everything. I don't know how much longer this sale is going to last. We have extended Brain Force, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and DNA Force. 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off DNA Force, and 40% off of Brain Force. We thank you for your support. And that's how we fund our operation. We're not controlled by corporate sponsors. We're not controlled by the Koch donors who are supporting Paul Ryan and Hillary Clinton and others. No, they don't support us. You support us, and we try to offer you products, the best products, to support your health. Now, one of the things that we haven't talked about in detail today, we talked about how Obama came after Donald Trump, called him unfit for office. He did that at a TPP conference where he's talking about, yeah, okay, we took a lot of jobs with our trade deals, and we're going to take a lot more. But, hey, it's something we have to do, you know, because his corporate sponsors want that. And so do Hillary Clinton's corporate sponsors. But here's the other thing that's truly amazing as we look at this. You know, Hillary Clinton is not interested in keeping the secrets of the intelligence community or national security, but they certainly can keep a secret for quite some time about how they got the release of these prisoners. And I remember this was a January release of four American prisoners, and he was roundly criticized not only for what he gave Iran last summer, okay, 6 months before this happened. He was criticized for the Iran deal. And people said, you're doing this deal with Iran. You're giving them all this money. You're relaxing the controls on their nuclear program. And yet you couldn't even get the release of these prisoners. So then in January, they did get the release of those prisoners. Now what we learn, 6 months again later, we learn that there was $400 million worth of cash. Now the story from Obama's administration is, hey, it was just part of that deal, you know. But look at the way they paid them. Wooden pallets stacked with euros, Swiss francs, and other currencies were secretly flown into Iran on an unmarked cargo plane. U.S. officials and congressional staff and European officials are now coming out with this information. Why 6 months later? You tell me. I don't know. Why would they do this at the same time they're putting out all of these phony criticisms of Donald Trump? Is like, look, you know, he told a lady in a joking way, hey, your baby's crying, can you please take him out? He made a joke of it. So that's the big deal. That's the big deal. Not this. Not the fact that these guys would use unmarked planes, foreign currencies, Swiss banks, secret flights to send in $400 million to ransom these prisoners. You know, think back about what Thomas Jefferson did. Remember when the first actions of the U.S. military abroad was against the Barbary pirates, who had a tradition of kidnapping people. And he realized that if you pay off kidnappers, you only get more kidnappings. Okay, so they sent in the Marines to the shores of Tripoli. That was a real Libyan operation. They rescued those people. They stopped the Barbary pirates. But we have people like Barack Obama secretly giving them that money, saying it's not ransom and saying, well, this is part of a payment of a 37-year-old dispute. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Globalist-owned mainstream media wants your mind, your vote, and ultimately, your rights. The political theater began with Donald Trump simply stating,
first of all, it's rigged. And I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest. Because I think my side was rigged. If I didn't win by massive landslides, I mean, think of what we won in New York and Indiana, California, 78%. That's with other people in the race.
Regardless of the fact that Hillary has so many skeletons in her closet, she has trouble closing the door, it's Donald Trump's character that is being ruthlessly attacked.
I think the Republican nominee is unfit to serve as president. I said so last week, and he keeps on proving it. The notion that he would attack a Gold Star family that had made such extraordinary sacrifices on behalf of our country.
Khazir Khan was a plant and a media trap. Khan should be seen for what he truly is, a civilizational jihadist.
It blows my mind even more than, say, this full court press with Khan, who got, what, 50 times more coverage than the Benghazi families in 3 days than they got in since Benghazi.
Yeah, they've been dehumanized.
But the WikiLeaks, which they turned into a Russia and Trump attack perfectly, the WikiLeaks shows that Politico, the Washington Post, name brand big shots like Chuck Todd and Jake Tapper, they're taking their instructions from the DNC.
In the 1980s, Khan wrote a paper expressing his admiration for Sharia law. And now, as Breitbart reports, Khazir Khan has deleted his law firm's website from the internet. As a lawyer, he engages in procurement of EB-5 immigration visas and other related immigration services. The EB-5 program, which helps wealthy foreigners, usually from the Middle East, essentially buy their way into America, is fraught with corruption. U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee Chairman Senator Chuck Grassley has detailed such corruption over the past several months.
This program has been plagued with fraud and abuse. But more importantly, it poses significant national security risk. Allegations suggesting the EB-5 program may be facilitating terrorist travel, economic espionage, money laundering and investment, fraud, are too serious of warnings against this bill to ignore, yet they're being ignored.
Khan is Muslim Brotherhood, as are staff within Obama's administration.
Why President Barack Hussein not hitting hard on the terrorists and on ISIS? And I know it sounds crazy, but bear with me. President Barack was born after his older brother, Malik. The father, Mr. Hussein, named his son Malik, and that's one of God's names in Islam. The second son, he named him Barak. What does Barak mean? Barak is the right Prophet Muhammad, and we can see Mr. Malik sitting with Mr. Obama visiting him in the White House. Mr. Malik is in charge of the Muslim Brotherhood in Africa. There's a lot of finances going on through Mr. Malik, and that explains that Mr. Barak Hussein is not hitting hard on the Muslim Brotherhood. On the contrary, he took them off the terrorist list. For years and years, the Muslim Brotherhood is on the terrorist list around the world. In the Arab world, who knows them best? But Mr. Barak decided to take them off the terrorist list and start to be sponsoring them and put them in charge of Egypt.
Caution. Hillary's camp will be setting more traps for Donald Trump as the race for the White House quickens. It is imperative that we see these quagmires for what they are. Donald Trump represents the average American fighting for the remaining cinders of the Constitution Obama and company have tossed onto the ash heap of history. Your vote and support for Trump is the only action that remains to pull our forefathers' genius from the fire. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
As we're talking about in the last segment before the top of the hour, the story that the Obama administration had paid $400 million in ransom. Of course, that's being pushed back by the Obama administration. They waited 6 months to tell everybody that this had happened. Why would they wait so long? Why would there be a coincidence that this money was paid after 37 years? This money, they say, hey, we've been in negotiations for a long time, and so we just decided we would pay them that. Because this is money that was seized. It was in a Pentagon trust fund. It was taken in 1979 as the Shah's regime fell. So the Iranian government has been trying to get it back ever since, along with interest. They said, oh, you know, we're going to just send that to them. It just doesn't have any connection at all to the fact that the same day they send the money back, the prisoners are released. No, 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 it's not ransom. And why would they send it from a Swiss bank? Actually, from a Swiss central bank. Swiss and Netherlands central banks put this money together. Well, they said, it's a bit of a logistical and security challenge. You don't just go down to the ATM and withdraw that kind of money, joked one of the officials. No, and if it's not ransom, you don't do it secretly on a secret plane loaded with cash, loaded with foreign cash. And I guess, you know, they couldn't find the money at the Federal Reserve. We have our own central bank, you know. They're printing tons of this stuff every day. That's part of the problem we have in this country is they print so much fiat currency. I mean, how phony can this get? And yet nobody is paying any attention to it. Remember, and rightfully so, the concern about Iran-Contra. Everybody was concerned about that during the Reagan administration. Nobody is really concerned about Iran-ISIS, are they? Okay? And, of course, at the time this happened, they have, in this story from Wall Street Journal, they point out Revolutionary Guard commanders boasted at the time, 6 months ago, that Americans had succumbed to Iranian pressure. They said, quote, taking this much money back was in return for the release of the American spies, said General Mohammad Reza Naghdi, commander of the Guard's militia, and he said it on state media. But, of course, it wasn't said on our mainstream media, was it? We don't like to talk about that kind of stuff because, you know, that would be kind of embarrassing to admit that the Obama administration had paid ransom for these prisoners. And, of course, they're taking more prisoners who have Western ties because they know that it works. When you feed that blackmail monster, when you feed the kidnapping monster, they just keep doing it. And, you know, when we look at this, this is something we talked about in the nightly news last night. It's very important to understand one of the key motivating factors behind the overthrow of Gaddafi. Why did he go from our trusted ally one day to someone who absolutely positively had to be killed, murdered, and drugged through the streets? Remember, as Hillary Clinton said, you know, we came, we conquered, he died, okay? Well, there's some interesting stuff that is coming out now in the WikiLeaks releases for everybody to see. And, of course, we said it at the time. Everybody was talking about, as we mentioned with Paul Joseph Watson when he was on earlier, the fact that Hillary Clinton, who says that Black Lives Matter, knew that there was a black genocide that was beginning there, that would happen. She was warned about that in the emails. She went ahead with it anyway because, you know, it was worth it. It was worth it to get Gaddafi out. At the same time, they're also doing gun running. The lady who wants to take our guns, law-abiding citizens' guns, in violation of the Constitution, that same woman does gun running to jihadi terrorists, arming ISIS, creating ISIS. They were warned at the time. We can see in the emails. They were warned that with these rebels that we're supporting, they're actually with Al-Qaeda. And now they're with ISIS. That's how this happened. But I want to focus again, as we're looking at this ransom money, this money that was taken in foreign currency from the Swiss and Netherlands central banks, loaded on pallets, flown out secretly in jets to Iran, paid as ransom, okay? And the fact we couldn't take that, I guess, from our central bank and didn't want people to know that. Let's look at this memo, just one of the many memos that came out that was released with WikiLeaks. This is from Sidney Blumenthal to Hillary Clinton. And he says, look, we have cultivated France to help us with this, and they've got some interests in Gaddafi's gold. What are they interested in about Gaddafi's gold? Well, they say that even though we have put we've frozen the accounts of Libya, it's not really going to stop them because Gaddafi has been setting up a currency to be backed by gold and silver. And he's got quite a bit of money. He's got 143 tons of gold and a similar amount of silver. And they said the gold was accumulated. This is an email that Sidney Blumenthal sent to Hillary Clinton. And Sidney tells Hillary, the gold was accumulated prior to the current rebellion and was intended to be used to establish a pan-African currency based on the Libyan golden dinar. The plan was designed to provide the Francophone African countries with an alternative to the French franc. He says this quantity of gold and silver is valued at more than $7 billion, and French intelligence officers discovered this plan shortly after the current rebellion began, they say. And this is one of the factors that influenced the French President Sarkozy to commit France to the attack, okay? And then he also mentions, oh, and they want their oil, too. They want greater share of Libya's oil production. They want to increase French influence in North Africa. They want to provide the French military with an opportunity to reassert its position in the world, and they want to address the concern of his advisors over Gaddafi's long-term plans to supplant France as the dominant power in Francophone Africa. Does this sound like a colonial move? See, this is nothing but colonialism. Remember, it was 2 years ago when they had the Bilderberg Conference in Copenhagen. one of the big topics of discussion was Africa. They want what they've got in terms of minerals. This is nothing but colonialism with a very sophisticated veneer. And it's also a very complex plan, very complex Machiavellian plan, because at the same time they're doing that, they can create civil war and unrest, create an arms bazaar out of Libya, which is what has happened, to create ISIS, to create unrest in all these countries that were on their list in the Middle East to take down. Why? Because they want their oil as well, right? And they don't want any competition to the petrodollar. Now, they couched this email to Hillary Clinton all about what's in it for France. This is presumably so she can make overtures to the French and bring them in. This is what they want, so you can reassure them that they're going to get all this stuff, okay? But look, America had a huge interest in this as well. It was our central bank that stopped the gold standard, Bretton Woods II. Kissinger and Nixon said you were going to go off the gold standard because everybody knew they'd already gone off the gold standard. They were printing so much money, there was absolutely no way they had gold reserves. So it wasn't honest anymore. So they came up with a new scheme. As they said, we're going to break our connection to gold. We're going to make the connection to oil. And they brought in Saudi Arabia as the partner. That's why Saudi Arabia has been protected. That's why Saudi Arabia is working hand in glove with the CIA, Prince Bandar, and all these other issues that you see with the missing 28, 29 pages. I mean, you can't tell where one intelligence agency stops and the other one starts. They have worked together to create a reserve currency, the petrodollar, that is essentially backed by the Saudi Arabians, using that as the denomination that they put all oil in. And so they didn't want to have this competition with Gaddafi. And, of course, there's other issues, too. I mean, they wanted the oil. They wanted the massive amount of underground water reserves that are there in Libya. There's a lot of reasons. But there's also the opportunity to create the unrest, then to export that unrest into European countries. They want to take every country down just as they've taken down Libya. What they did to Libya, you have to understand, Hillary Clinton and the globalists want to do the same thing to the West. They want to do it to all the European countries. They want to do it to America. They are going to turn us into the same kind of third world country that they have done to these countries. And now what they have is a new way to label us, okay? They want to talk about how people who oppose open borders, people who oppose the so-called free trade agreements, which are not free trade agreements. These are agreements that are going to allow our economy to be managed by people who have no accountability to us, who are not Americans, who are not British, who are not French or whatever. It's going to be unaccountable committees that are going to manage all of our economies without any control from us, okay? But if you oppose that, you are closed. That's the way they're going to start referring to you. They always use the language to take the high ground, the argumentative high ground. As New American points out, globalists' new propaganda technique is to call people who are patriots, people who are nationalists, they're going to call us closed. The globalists, the elites, they will be called open. And you have to understand what they're trying to do. Again, going back to the founders, there was socialism that has been around in one form or the other for a very long time. As long as we've had envy, as long as we've had theft, we've had arguments for political socialism. Now, at the time of the Founding Fathers, it was called, they referred to these people not as socialists. That came out of the French Revolution. They called them levelers. They said, you want to take everybody down to the same level. You have to understand, this is what the globalist elite want to do. They want to level us. When they say, we want to have a global community, a united one world. Okay, you know what level of economic activity that one world is going to be? It's going to be at the level of the lowest third world countries. Look at the Drudge Report today. They have an article about how the UN wants to tax meat out of affordability. They want to tax our meat where we can't afford it. They want to tax our energy where we can't afford it. They want to control our transportation so that we can no longer afford to own cars. All the cars will be owned by one or two globalists like Uber. And they will control and track and tax our transportation, our movement. Everything that we see, that they don't want us to have air conditioning. They want to take us down to third world levels. So they are not open, okay? We need to start referring to them as the levelers. You want a one world? You want a unified world government? You want everybody to be equal? You know where that equality is going to be? It's going to be as a third world colonial occupied country. That's what they're going to do to us. That's what they did to Libya. That's what they're in the process of trying to do here in America and in the West. Stay with us. We'll be right back. There's breaking news about Paul Ryan's election. He's been endorsed now. We're going to have a special report from Alex Jones coming up in the next segment. This is something that is really about the theme that we had last week with our 28-hour sale, Awakening the Sleeping Giant. Who's the sleeping giant? You are. The listeners. The vast amount of humanity who would stand against the elite, just as we were talking about in the last segment. What they want to do is they want to level us to the level of third world countries. They want to take away everything from our energy to our freedom to move about. And we've seen this happen before in Libya. And we're seeing the kind of same strategies that they're doing now in first world countries, creating war, creating division, creating terrorism, and then clamping down and shutting down our economies multiple ways, through taxes, through regulation, through letting our economies be managed by foreign committees who will decide which countries will be able to have which industries, if any. And guess who's going to benefit? They're going to benefit from that. So we're going to have a special report coming up in the next segment from Alex Jones about the sleeping giant. He's going to talk about the spirit of humanity that needs to be awakened, that is awakening. And also about the globalist plan. And I just want to also let you know that we have extended the sale of some of the items that we had as part of that giant mega sale that we had at the Sleeping Giant sale. We have three products, Brain Force, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and DNA Force that we have extended. We have 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and that, of course, is a drink mix that gives you a broad variety of vitamins and minerals, and 30% off DNA Force. That is a huge savings. That is a very expensive, very difficult product to manufacture. BioPQQ is the key ingredient in that. There's 175 clinical studies. You can read about that, as well as that's what makes it very difficult to manufacture, very expensive to produce. So if you get 30% off of DNA Force, that is a huge savings. Plus, we have store-wide free shipping on everything at InfoWarsStore.com. So we've extended those three products, and we have store-wide free shipping still, but it's not going to last too much longer. We thank you for your support. Now, as we're looking at what happened in Libya, and we look at what's happening in the first world countries, understand that things are developing very quickly in Venezuela. There was a report earlier this week that sounds exactly like Chairman Mao's Cultural Revolution. Venezuela, this is CNN, Venezuela's new decree forced farm work for citizens. Remember when Chairman Mao did that? When they couldn't even grow rice in China? Okay, they drove the people out of the cities. Well, they're doing the same thing in Venezuela because the people can't even get food. They're having to go to other countries to try to get this. And this has been developing slowly over a period of time. Remember, it was 3 years ago that we pointed out that Bloomberg was bragging about how Hugo Chavez, the socialist, and his successor were giving 700% return on investment to who? To the bankers, okay? The same people that were concerned that Libya was going to create a gold-backed currency to compete against the fiat petrodollar and other central bank currencies. So now we've got in Venezuela, they said, hey, he understands that the banks get paid first, okay? So we'll kind of leave him alone for a while, but the system is collapsing. Because it's socialism, but also because there are things that they want there, okay? But listen, this is what's happening there. This is what Amnesty International says this effectively amounts to forced labor. They said the decree is unlawful. Public and private sector employees, in other words, anybody with a job, okay, probably the people who don't have a job because they got a lot of people who are unemployed, would be forced to work in the country's fields for at least a 60-day period. Which may be extended if circumstances merit. Oh, you can bet it will be. You can bet it will be. And we've got our own Grand Mao who is running for president, Hillary Clinton, and she's going to do the same thing for us. And then they point back. They don't go back to Chairman Mao's Cultural Revolution, but they do refer to how this was similar to what the communist Cuban government did. Yeah, see, they always run out of other people's money. They always resort to slave labor. The same thing happened in East Germany. They said as riots began to break out there because the workers couldn't get paid, They said, I guess, and this is something that came out of, is a quote from Bertolt Brecht. This is in 1953 when they were having riots. You want to talk about minimum wage, Democrats? Understand the socialism that you support doesn't even work in Venezuela. It doesn't work in Eastern Germany. The people there were starving as well. They took to the streets to say they wanted higher pay raise, and they hit them with a militarized crackdown on the demonstrators, to which Bertolt Brecht wrote out after that. He said, wouldn't it be easier for the government to dissolve the people and elect another? And that's precisely what's going on throughout the West. The government is dissolving the people and exchanging us for a different population, one that will be more malleable. And, of course, as we look at what's happening in Venezuela, understand that, like Libya, they have massive amounts of natural resources, four times the current gold reserves everywhere, 12 times the number, the amount of all diamonds known in existence. They want to get their hands on that, and they want to get their hands on rare earth minerals. We'll be right back with Alex Jones.
I'm in a battle. I know the globalists are using covert warfare against humanity. It pisses me off. And it's not because I'm a hero. If I see someone choking, I give them the Heimlich maneuver. If I see my neighbor's house on fire, I go try to put it out. If you punch me in the nose, I attack you back. That's normal. I'm like my ancestors before me. And I'm here to try to get our basic instincts firing again, because we've been basically put into a coma, artificially put into a trance. We're under attack. That's why I say that which doesn't kill you, to quote Nietzsche, that which doesn't kill you only makes you stronger. Even though one of my eyes hardly points the right direction, both my hands have been broken more than 20 times apiece, even though I got scars all over my face, and even though I've had my leg broken, and even though I've been pile-drived repeatedly into solid concrete, it was those primitive animating contests of liberty that made me into what I am today. It was the things that actually activated the human race consciousness in me, the survival consciousness. And I realize everything the system's done is to try to keep us from having those rites of passage. Freedom and the Second Amendment and free speech and culture is all I've got. I look at the criminals at the DNC and the establishment RNC people, and look at how empty they are. And when they talk to each other, the politicos are just such empty, fake, scared husks. And I just want people to know that I'm not with those people, and I never will be. I'm a passion-filled man. I'm alive. I want a future for humanity. And I'm not scared. And I'm ready to fight. And say what you want about a Donald Trump or a Vladimir Putin or an Alex Jones or a Matt Drudge or anybody else that opposes this. You look at us, you see people that are awake. You see people that are alive. You see people that have friendliness and goodwill. Not men that want to die, not men that want to be martyrs, but men and women who aren't going to stand by and watch a bunch of hateful scum have their way with humanity. And we must believe again. We must have faith again. We must be honorable again. We are a college, a compendium, a chronicle, a clearinghouse, a meeting place, a focal point of humans trying to understand the mega corporations' games, trying to understand and read their own white papers, trying to discover our own destiny, while at the same time they're trying to cut us off from it. You will not find enlightenment. You will not find fulfillment. You will not find empowerment. You will not find strength in Hollywood, mainstream media culture. Everything it sells you is pure liquid death. despite all the mainstream media demonizations, despite all the claims we're not for real, and notice they always say that because they know we're real. They know. And they know you're real. And they know you're beautiful in your soul. These people say, oh my God, well, either like, oh, you're just a crazy person, or, oh my God, you're this hero. The world is trying to steal your birthright. It's trying to make men and women unhappy because they live in a little apartment and because they don't have all the money, or their neighbors look down on them, or the bill collectors, the taxes. The fact that you are with your children, the fact that you're loving them and turning that television off, the fact that you're taking them into the park to be in that grass, the fact that you're honorable and good and remember your ancestors takes you right to God's bosom. And just as children need to be at the bosom and the chest of their fathers and their mothers, you need to ask God to take you to his heart, to her heart, because God is all. Everything will be made clear. The enemy will be broken. This system that's only there to test us, you will know, is already fallen. I want everybody to know something, though. Whether the government comes down on me, corrupt elements, assassination, whatever, I know my children are going to be taken care of. That's my deal with God. But I realize that time-space is really one system, and it's a continuum of that human experience in this third and fourth and fifth and sixth dimension. And I can just say that it is our common human experience. We are the people that came before us. And so that's why I'm so honored to be here now fighting this, because I was born to do it. But the whole world was about directing me into some type of profession or something I was supposed to do. But men, first and foremost, are supposed to go out and labor. But in every culture that's somewhat free, when they're done, even if it's 7 at night, they go and get politically involved. They're involved in the councils of government. If you don't get involved, you hand the floor over to the enemy. And the people that want to run this planet are threatened by the power of the average person. They are threatened by the innate will of God expressed through our species. No wonder they want to merge with machines and do all this, because they are fundamentally scared of the vastness of the universe. They are fundamentally scared of that consciousness that is dialing into God's will. They want to pretend that their gods, that they will organize and direct the human species, and then they made the decision that we're failed and fundamentally fallen. See, they're playing God. And that we must be exterminated before they sanctify us, as we merge with silicon, so we can be perfectly programmed with zeros and ones. That is a vision of the devil himself. The devil is a cancer in the fabric of space and time. It doesn't create anything. It expropriates the grid, the system, and then creates mutations. Things that create harmony and beauty and timelessness and transcendence are of God. I have seen the visions of the enemy. I have been to the enemy's fortress, and I can tell you that on that planet of death is nothing that will empower us. if you tuned in, you've heard a lot of stuff. You heard a lot of different. They put out so many flavors of ideas, so many spectrums of information. People say, "Oh, that's just one more person." The truth is that Donald Trump knows I'm not just one more person. And it's not a power trip. It's just recognizing what it is. And the Russian government realizes I'm not just one more person. And the Vatican realizes I'm not just one more person. And the whole other system. And they realize you're not just one other person. I'm just somebody that's gotten to a point to resist it. I'm just one of many who understand this and who the spirit of liberty and God is coursing through. The point is that this is a spiritual battle. And almost everyone else tunes in to what's happening. We all have a sixth sense to a certain extent, some stronger than others. And I've not been scared to put my will out there and say, I'm not going to bend to evil. And that's all. It's really not even that special in many respects. It's just that to tell you this personal story, people need to understand how serious this is. That my whole life was an education, was an experience, was things more fantastical than the last. Look at what's happening now. And everything the system does is to tell you InfoWars is not fantastical, InfoWars is not important, because if you believe InfoWars is important, you believe you're important. Donald Trump knows what he's doing with true hope about empowering things and the economy and jobs and industry and lower taxes. That's real hope. And Donald Trump is actually a very, very humble person and a very, very in tune person, a very, very psychic person, just like Stanley Kubrick was. And the more you learn in this world, the more you realize that everything is about being intuitive. And what would you say to women out there that are buying into this corrupt system? Doesn't their intuition tell them they're being trapped? Doesn't intuition tell them they're the magic machine that makes the babies? That with a man and woman, you can create a whole new world? How magic we are together? How we're timelessly together? We're one? How holy that is? And the system is attacking that fundamentally? I feel so sorry for women, because women, despite all the evil in the culture, they have retained their innate strength in many ways. And men are so fallen because their fathers didn't test them. My mother's come to me. She remembers a few years ago, she apologized to me and hugged me like Thanksgiving. She said, I'm sorry I was so rough on you. I'm sorry we didn't protect you. And I looked at my mother and I said, no, thank you for everything you did. She said, but we just didn't want you to be a wimp. I want you as listeners to understand this. I mean, you know, we never brag about what we do or how what we're doing, except to tell you we're having an effect thanks to your support. But whether it's the Syrian resistance or the Japanese government or the Russian government or elements of our government, they all listen. We don't have wireheads in the matrix listening. We really do have the sincere, serious people watching. And that's why we need your prayers, we need your hope, and we need you to send the links to our articles, our videos, our podcasts, all the stuff at InfoWars.com/show. Everything I do is about fighting the globalists. It funds us, it helps you get good food, and it gets things planted that are countering them.
Talk show host is Alex Jones. He's a conspiracy theorist.
Radio talk show host Alex Jones.
Alex Jones.
Jones is the wildly popular conspiracy theorist.
Radio talk show host and conspiracy theorist Alex Jones.
Deeply, I think, racist.
I just got called racist by MSNBC.
I don't want that man to have a gun.
1776 will commence again if you try to take our firearms.
The Alex Jones Show. Watch the free stream live at Infowars.com/show.
And of course, that was Alex Jones and part of what we had as our sleeping giant, or Operation Awake the Sleeping Giant. We had a 28-hour telethon where we offered massive sales, and we still have three of those items on sale with big discounts. 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off DNA Force and store-wide free shipping. We've extended that. I don't know how much longer that's going to run. But again, that is what helps us to awaken the public, to awaken the sleeping giant. Just as people didn't realize for an entire year what was going on with the, it's been called the bad deal with Iran. Yeah, it was a bad deal. The deal that Obama made last summer, handing over money to them, giving them permission for their nuclear program. And yet, that wasn't all he had planned. 6 months later, he ransomed four prisoners. Everybody was saying, you couldn't at least get those prisoners released last summer? Well, now we find out they did. They sent over $400 million on a secret plane, as we just mentioned. That is absolutely amazing. Foreign currency from a foreign central bank secretly sent in, and now we find out about it 6 months later. That's what we're up against, folks. Now, let's talk politics a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about the election. I want to talk about all the breaking news that we're seeing about how the elections are going to be rigged. And we got a lot of different ways, of course, that the system knows how to rig the elections. But we got an election before the presidential election that's coming up that's very important. Next Tuesday, Paul Ryan is running for re-election in a primary. And there is a significant challenger there that he does not want you to know about. So we're going to tell you a little bit about him. But today, Donald Trump's running mate, Mike Pence, endorsed Paul Ryan in this primary that's coming up on Tuesday. He said that Trump and Ryan would do great things if elected. Well, actually, if they're both elected, Paul Ryan is going to be the biggest obstacle to Donald Trump controlling the borders and changing these trade agreements that are destroying our jobs. Paul Ryan has been in with the globalists on both of those things. And it's kind of interesting, you know, because in the past, Paul Ryan said, well, you know, when it comes to Donald Trump, I'm really not there yet. And when people asked Donald Trump about Paul Ryan, he just repeated that. He says, well, I'm really not there yet. I'm not there yet. And then Paul Ryan came back and echoed what Trump said. You know, Trump said at the time, he said, well, I didn't ask him for his endorsement. And so Paul Ryan said, well, I didn't ask Trump for his endorsement. But now we've got Mike Pence, the consummate establishment politician, saying, I spoke to Donald Trump this morning about my support for Paul Ryan, our long friendship, and he strongly encouraged me to endorse Paul Ryan in next Tuesday's primary, and I'm pleased to do so. Now, they point out in the CNBC article that Trump has previously praised Ryan's opponent, Paul Nehlen, in this primary on Tuesday. And here's the strategy, according to The Hill. The strategy is really just to ignore him, to not mention his name, to pretend that he doesn't exist. That's why we're going to talk about it. We're going to say, Paul Nehlen, N-E-H-L-E-N. The primary is next Tuesday. You can vote even if you're a Democrat. It is an open primary. If you want to make a statement about how our country is being turned over to multinational globalist elitists with these phony trade deals, they're not about free trade at all, folks. This is a managed economy, an economy managed by somebody else other than you. And it's not just about economics. It's really about our sovereignty. And we can see it in a number of ways directly. Shutting down labeling, saying that you're not going to be able to know what's in your food. If they want to put GMO in there, you can't label that. They're going to shut it down at an international level. They're going to restrict our internet freedoms. That's all in these things. That's what Paul Ryan is supporting. And when we come back, we're going to tell you a little bit more about that election. We're going to tell you a little bit more about the difference, because Paul Ryan wants to pretend that he doesn't have a challenger, because that's the strategy that they're going to take. Just ignore him. Say that he doesn't exist. Don't mention his name. We're going to talk about it. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. Let's talk a little bit about the elections. And I'm not talking about the one coming up in November. I'm talking about the one coming up next Tuesday. Most of us can't participate in this, but even Democrats in Wisconsin and Paul Ryan's district can participate. This is a perfect way for them to send a message to the globalists. Now, we've had Mike Pence come out and say, hey, if Trump and Ryan are both elected, they can do great things together. Well, let's look at that a little bit. Let's look at the standing ovation that was given to Paul Ryan at a Koch brothers donor party. Okay, this was reported by Breitbart, and they said, speaking at a lavish retreat for 400 donors hosted by the Koch brothers, Paul Ryan said it was incumbent on the party to repudiate the views of Republican voters who don't support open trade. Okay, he reportedly assured donors that he'll work to win some of these fights and advance their agenda on TPP. The Washington Post reports that his message was not only warmly received, but he was clearly a favorite of the Koch donors. He was received with a standing ovation with hoops and hollers. The audience interrupted him several times with hearty applause. They say he echoed the sentiment of Washington conservatives like talk radio host Mark Levin. He expressed his concern that the Republican Party has been taken over by progressive populists. No, not progressive. Not progressive, but you can call it populist. Call it nationalist. That's really the true agenda here, okay? Call it Jeffersonian. Because, you know, in the second inaugural address, as I've mentioned before, Thomas Jefferson said, we have eliminated useless offices and along with it, extra taxes. So we can say that we have eliminated all internal taxation in the country. They funded a constitutionally sized government strictly off of tariffs of goods coming in and out of the country. And he said, what farmer, what laborer, what mechanic knows a tax man? None. Wouldn't you like to have a country like that? You know what happened? We used to have a country that was constitutionally sized. We used to have a government that was the right size, that minded its own business, that obeyed the restrictions that were put on it by the Constitution. But when we became an empire, they needed other ways to fund it. And they said, we're going to come up with free trade. You know when they gave us so-called free trade? They also gave us the income tax because they lost the tariffs. Well, they replace it with an income tax. That's what you get with these people. But, of course, Mark Levin says the Republican Party is now the party of progressive Republicans. Theodore Roosevelt, the protectionists, the Ross Perots, the Pat Buchanan, the no-growthers. You know where no growth comes from? It comes from exporting your jobs. It comes from eviscerating your manufacturing base. All these free trade people told us, and we've heard it, same story, the same siren song from the libertarian, Gary Johnson, saying, you know, we want to have service jobs. Those are clean jobs. You've heard that before, right? We don't want that dirty manufacturing. We want service jobs. And, you know, it's not even the service jobs now. It's the gigs, you know, the temporary, very temporary jobs, because Uber jobs, and that's what Gary Johnson said in his debates. He said, it's the Uber economy. It's not just Uber, but it's Airbnb and all these other things. You know, that's where the future is. So you're not even going to have a full-time service job. You can forget your minimum wage increases, okay? You have to have real wealth. You have to be able to produce real stuff. That means you need a manufacturing base. That's where you really produce it. The service economy will grow, but the base is the manufacturing base. If you eviscerate that base, we now know. Because we've seen NAFTA, we've seen how these things work. We've seen how the Koch brothers work. And we understand that the policy of Paul Ryan is just to pretend that Paul Nehlen, his challenger, doesn't exist. Last month, Paul Nehlen went out in front of his gated mansion with a wall and said, hey, if you don't want a wall for America to protect us, then take down your wall. Well, his strategy was to just ignore it because he said Eric Cantor challenged his opponent. We don't want anybody to even know that Paul Ryan has an opponent, but he does. And you can vote against him even if you're a Democrat. Stay with us when we come back. We're going to talk about the election being rigged in November. We'll be right back.
You said in a speech today you're afraid this election is going to be rigged.
I've been hearing about it for a long time, and I hope the Republicans get out there and watch very closely.
This new poll is showing a big convention bounce for Hillary Clinton.
Following her nomination at the Democratic National Convention, Hillary Clinton now leads it. Donald Trump, 50% to 42%. That's a 7-point jump from last week.
You see, he's supposed to just sit there and let them steal it, but he didn't sit there, so they failed. And they think they're going to have another stolen general election in front of everybody at high noon, and we're just going to sit here and go along with it. We're not. I'm going to fight it. Trump's going to fight it. You're going to fight it.
Bob Mulholland from Chico, California. I'm a DNC member, thus a superdelegate to the national convention.
First of all, it's rigged. And I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest.
And the way we work is that anybody who gets 15% more in election gets delegates. So this election will go all the way to California. Sanders will end up with well over 1,000 delegates, and Hillary will get the nomination.
Hillary Clinton.
Like Debbie said from the start.
Hillary Clinton has had every advantage, every break given to her from the very beginning by this Democratic Party. It has been rigged.
It is clearly the case that when given truth serum, Debbie Wasserman Schultz vastly prefers Hillary Clinton to be the nominee, obviously, and to the extent there are things that can be done institutionally and marginally to facilitate that outcome, they are being done.
If Hillary steals the nomination and then she openly is engaged in chicanery and things don't add up with Trump, you have to say it must be thrown out.
The political parties choose their nominee, not the general public.
contrary to popular belief.
Then why bother holding the primaries?
That's a very good question.
WikiLeaks has dumped nearly 20,000 hacked emails from the DNC.
We're talking about the report of leaked DNC emails showing an effort to undermine Bernie Sanders during the primaries.
The American people are sick and tired of hearing about your damn emails.
Thank you.
When did the press see it as their role to protect the prerogative of the powerful? Actually, I think that's part of it.
And we're not going to recognize Queen Hillary if there's evidence of fraud. And guess what there is? She stole the nomination.
I want to thank Bernie Sanders.
If he would have just not done anything, just go home, go to sleep, relax, he would have been a hero. But he made a deal with the devil. She's the devil.
The media has created the perception that the voters will decide the nomination, and that's the conflict. That's the conflict here.
We feel like we live in a democratic society. What you're telling me is it's not a democratic society, and your votes don't necessarily matter because it's a democratic representation.
Crooked Hillary thinks they're going to pull what they did on Mitt Romney. Lady, isn't going to happen. That's why her campaign head, her chief strategist, said this is dangerous. What Trump's doing. You're right. It is dangerous, isn't it? Actually standing up to you.
I continue to believe Mr. Trump will not be president.
And I'm telling you, November 8th, we better be careful because that election's going to be rigged.
Yes, I think the Republican nominee is unfit to serve as president.
And I hope the Republicans are watching closely or it's going to be taken away from us.
You're going to be hearing a lot more about this, ladies and gentlemen, because Donald Trump's not going to let you be robbed, myself be robbed, or him be robbed or his family.
There has to come a point at which you say, enough.
Okay, and that's how they're going to steal the election. And you know, the interesting thing I think about this is the fact that Donald Trump isn't going to sit quietly by and allow this to happen. He's already saying they're going to rig the election. We've seen how they tried to rig the election throughout the process. I mean, there's a lot of different ways that you can rig election. We're going to talk about it when we come back in detail. But already when he comes out and says, hey, I'm afraid the election is going to be rigged. Well, CNN comes back and says, even for a reflexive conspiracy theorist, so that's what they always say when they don't have a genuine comeback. They just dismiss it as a conspiracy theorist. For a reflexive conspiracy theorist like Trump, even this is pathetic. It's dangerous as well. That's what they tweet out. So we're going to tell you why he is not a conspiracy theorist. There are people who are conspiring to rig the election, to rig the voting machines. Do you remember 2000? Do you remember? Have you not learned anything? And we're going to talk about how this has happened internationally. And we're going to give you examples of how they do it when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show, our last hour. I'm David Knight here in the Austin studios. Last week, I was at the DNC in Philadelphia. And I remember how excited the Wall Street publications were that Hillary Clinton had picked Kaine as her VP. They were saying a lot of Wall Street executives are now traveling to Philly because this is the real deal. Now, Hillary has been out on the campaign trail after the DNC. And I want to play for you how she was received by some of the people in the crowd. Here's that clip. Got that clip?
Who's gotten a lot of attention and who, you know, has a very novel way of running for president because he doesn't tell you what he's going to do. But slowly,
we know exactly what she's
going to
do.
Clear.
Those people are chanting. If you couldn't make out what they were chanting, they're saying Wall Street has bought her. We know exactly what Hillary Clinton is going to do. It's one of the things Julian Assange said. He said, you know, Trump is totally unpredictable as far as he's concerned. I think he is predictable on things like trade. And some of the Democrats that I talked to were very surprised when they found out that Donald Trump was taking out ads against NAFTA and many of these other globalist trade deals that were bad deals for the United States. Just as Ross Perot pointed it out, he was taking out ads at his own expense, spending $100,000 30, 35 years ago to tell people what a bad deal these trade deals were. He's been consistent on that for decades. So I think we do know what he's going to do when it comes to the trade deals. He is unpredictable on some other things. But as Julian Assange pointed out, Hillary Clinton is absolutely predictable. We know that she hates free speech. We know that she hates freedom of the press. We know that she's going to go to war. We know that she is owned by Wall Street, by Goldman Sachs, by foreign governments, by the Saudis who funded 20% of her campaign, they bragged. And so, yeah, Wall Street has bought her. Now, somebody else that they bought is Paul Ryan. And I just read to you in the last hour how when he went to the Coke donor event, about 400 big bucks people, they were cheering him left and right. Okay, they loved what he had to say. And his strategy is going to be different, according to The Hill. Unlike Eric Cantor, who was really the number two. Remember, he was the number two in the Republican Party, and he lost his primary battle. They say, unlike Cantor, who ran a spate of negative TV ads against his opponent, Ryan hasn't directly engaged with Paul Nehlen in media interviews, nor in campaign ads. So he completely ignores him, pretends he doesn't exist, doesn't take out any negative ads against him because he doesn't want anybody to know that he's even got anybody running against him. What does he do instead, okay? His TV ads are touting the bond that he shares with his mother. Mother and apple pie, it's morning in America, and you spell that with a U, okay? Because you look at what Paul Ryan has done to America, and it is morning with a U, if you understand what he has done to our country. They say he touts the bond that he shares with his mother and his positive election year agenda dubbed a better way. It's not a better way. It's the way that he's been doing ever since he got into Congress. He has been an open border guy ever since he got in Congress. He has been for globalist trade deals ever since he got in Congress. He doesn't have a better way. He's got the same way that he has offered us his entire time. And then one of the people here who's a GOP strategist says, you don't want to build up Nehlen's name ID because most of his constituents don't know who he is. You know what? I don't think a lot of constituents know who Paul Ryan is either. But Paul Nehlen, his opponent, does. And this story from Breitbart, he called Paul Ryano a soulless globalist. He said he's a conservative. He says Paul Ryan says that he's a conservative from the conservative wing of the Republican Party, but he's not. He's a soulless globalist from the Democrat wing of the Uni Party. You understand that? The Democrats and the Republicans at the top. There is no difference between Paul Ryan and Nancy Pelosi on these issues of national sovereignty, on the borders, on the trade deals. There's no difference between them. None whatsoever. And on the issues that there is a difference, his challenger, his Republican challenger, is on the right side of those issues. Why would you vote for Paul Ryan? And if you are a Democrat in an area where you've got an open primary, send the message to the globalists, defeat this guy like they did Eric Cantor. And this is what Nehlen said. He said, can you name me the last time that Paul Ryan worked as hard for Wisconsin as he has for corporate America? I can't. I can't think of one time. He called him an open borders politician. He said Paul Ryan was grown in a Petri dish in D.C. He is absolutely an open borders guy through and through. You have to understand that's the situation there. And those people who are chanting, Wall Street has bought her, you have an opportunity, and it's the only way it's going to happen, is if Republicans stand together with independents, with Democrats, to shut down these globalists. Okay? You got the people like Mark Levin out there saying, this is horrible. You know, these people are populist. Well, you know what? Mark Levin is one of these neocon globalists who is not only with her, he's with war, okay? These people tout war at every chance. And they also want to go through and rewrite the Constitution, a constitutional convention. Do you really trust these criminals like Hillary Clinton and Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell and Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi? Do you really trust those people, the same people that are the superdelegates? Do you trust them to rewrite the Constitution? No. We don't have a problem with the Constitution. We have a problem with lawless politicians who believe they are above the law, like Hillary Clinton. So we have laws against criminal actions. We have laws against corruption. We have laws against most of what the federal government does. We have a failure to, what we have here is a failure not to communicate, but a failure to do what the Constitution says. And it isn't going to change anything if you have the criminals who are openly violating the law and getting away with it. If you have those same criminals rewrite the Constitution, no, then they're just going to give themselves another way to escape punishment. Let's talk about the next election, because in the last couple of days, Donald Trump understands that Crooked Hillary is going to be pulling some levers on this election. On Tuesday, He went on the O'Reilly Factor. He said, well, I'm looking at all these decisions that are coming down from the standpoint of voter ID and voter identification. What's he talking about? I think he's talking about this Supreme Court decision that came out on Monday in North Carolina. We'll tell you about that in a moment. And he says, I'm saying, what do you mean? You don't have to have a voter ID to go in and vote. It's a little bit scary. I've heard a lot of bad things. He said the whole thing with voter identification, I think, is really, I mean, people are going to walk in. They're going to vote 10 times, maybe. Who knows? They're going to vote 10 times. Oh, is that a conspiracy theory? Well, CNN says it is. You know, CNN says, Trump says, I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged. Okay? And as I mentioned earlier, Hillary Clinton's spokesperson mocked Donald Trump on Twitter on Tuesday. And he said, even for a reflexive conspiracy theorist like Trump, this is pathetic. And it's dangerous, too. Why is it dangerous? It's dangerous for them, not for you. It's dangerous for them if you know that they're rigging the elections and you understand how they're rigging the elections. Now, he says this is a conspiracy theory. Well, you know, Wired Magazine is a pretty left-leaning publication now, very heavily into the globalist, elitist, Democrat camp. And they had this article, which came out yesterday. America's electronic voting machines are scarily easy targets. That's not a conspiracy theory, folks. It is a demonstrated fact. We've seen it over and over again. I mean, years ago, and we've played these old clips. I mean, it's even in a 4-3 aspect ratio. It's so old. You've got a mainstream local news organization that has somebody come in, and I think it was up in Pittsburgh. I think it was Carnegie Mellon or some school like that. But they had a professor and two of his students come in, take over the voting machine, rig the elections. No matter who you picked, they said, okay, here's this voting machine. And they had like George Washington and John Adams or whatever. So you watch them make the selections. They'd make three votes. And then the machine prints out who was chosen. And they completely switched it around and then erased all evidence that it had been hacked. And as they point out in this Wired article, they said, well, you know, states have had plenty of warning. There was a damning report done by the Brennan Center for Justice about how voting machines were vulnerable. That was done last September. And they say, well, maybe they fixed it by now. And say, no, they're not fixing it. They want it to be tamperable. Okay. That's what they want. They said, well, you know, you would think, even going back to the 2000 election, we had all the hanging chads and everything, the Bush-Gore deadlock, you know. Well, what came out of that was something called Help America Vote Act. Which is going to do just the opposite, folks. Whenever they come up with a bill, okay, like the Patriot Act, you know that it's going to be the most unpatriotic thing you've ever seen, okay? Well, the Helping America Vote Act actually helps them to take America's vote, really. It worked to phase out the use of punch card voting systems that were the focus of that, but then it moved to electronic voting systems, which solves the problems of a hanging chad, but it makes it even more vulnerable to manipulation, as we have shown over and over again. And as Wired Magazine points out, a lot of these systems even go back and use very old operating systems at their core that are very easily hacked. They point out Windows XP, for example, hasn't had a security patch since April of 2014. So it's been 2 years that this thing, it's not even really being supported by Microsoft anymore. And they point out that it's not just hypothetical. Late last summer, Virginia decertified thousands of insecure WinVote machines, okay, that's based on that operating system. We got a report here from John Rappaport. Another way that they're going to rig the voting system, and this isn't even the superdelegates, okay? You got to understand that the superdelegates were just part of it, okay? These electronic voting machines are one of the worst things to come along in terms of honesty that we've seen in a long time. Now, in this report, John Rappaport is talking to Bev Harris, who we've interviewed many times here at Infowars.com. She has a site called blackboxvoting.org. If you want to educate yourself about the many different ways that the election can be rigged, go to Black Box Voting and look at it. She spells that out. And we're going to spell out some of those ways when we come back to you. But the thing that triggered this all was North Carolina. You have to understand that where they sit right now, Clinton is at 47.3, Trump is at 47. All they have to do is flip a few things. And they said they're not going to allow, it's racist, to have voter ID in North Carolina. That's what Obama and Clinton judges said on Monday. That's why Trump is saying that. We're going to take your phone calls in the next segment. If you want to call in, that number is 800-259-9231. That's 800-259-9231. You want to weigh in on the election or some of these other issues that we've talked about today, we're going to open up the lines for your phone calls. I just want to remind you also that we have extended the Sleeping Giant Mega Specials. That was that 28-hour broadcast that we did 1 week ago. We've extended that for you on three products, 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and 30% off DNA Force. We have also added store-wide free shipping. Check out the reviews of those products, especially the savings that you'll find on DNA Force. As we've mentioned before, that patented BioPQQ compound that is backed by 175 clinical studies is very difficult to manufacture, very expensive to produce. A 30% discount off of DNA Force is a huge savings off of one of our premier products for your health. And again, we thank you for your support, and we have extended these three products. We have to hold things back in reserve because we do have auto ship customers that we have committed to, so these cannot run too much longer. But you'll find those discounts off of Brain Force, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and DNA Force, as well as store-wide free shipping on everything at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, real quickly, before we go to your phone calls, and I want to finish up on this voting rigging. This is an article by John Rappaport. He references Bev Harris at blackboxvoting.org, and he talks about something other than identifying the voters. See, there's a lot of different ways that you can cheat. You can have people who are not legally registered as voters, and you can rig things there. You cannot ID people, which is what is in view with North Carolina. That's what Donald Trump was responding to directly, I believe, when they had these Democrat judges shut down a lower circuit judge decision. He did a 485-page decision talking about why it's okay to have photo IDs to identify voters. Okay. If that is racist, folks, and we had Attorney General Loretta Lynch say it is racist, then the Democrats are racist because they were checking our ID everywhere. The TSA is racist because you can't fly on a plane without showing your picture ID. All of the grocery stores and then any of the retail outlets where you cash a check, they're all racist because they also use photo ID to check people. There is nothing racist about checking photo ID. And when you say you don't want to do that, okay, you're trying to rig the system with illegitimate voters. So first part of making sure you've got honest elections is to identify the voters. The other part of it is to correctly record the vote. So we've talked about how that can be done. It's been demonstrated on live news media reports for many years, how it's very easy to rig the actual voting process with electronic votes. Then the next thing is, how do you record those votes and report those votes? That's what this is about, this John Rappaport article. They're talking about a system called GEMS, okay, G-E-M-S. And it shows that one vote can be counted 25 times, another one only 1/1000th of a time, effectively converting some of those votes to zero. They say the report summarizes results of the review of the GEMS election management system, which counts approximately 25% of all the votes in the United States. So you understand, if this is the totaling of the votes where they can rig it. So they can rig who votes, they can rig when you vote, and then they can rig the counting of the votes as it's being tabulated and reported. This tampering is not visible to election observers because, you know, it's electronic. That's the problem with these electronic machines. Even if you're standing in the room, even if you're watching the computer, because they are rounding these up or down, weighting these votes inside the computer. Who has this system? Well, it is being used in systems throughout Alaska, Connecticut, Georgia, Mississippi, New Hampshire, Utah, Vermont, and then in counties in Arizona, California, Colorado, Florida, Illinois, Indiana, Iowa, Kansas, Kentucky, Massachusetts, Michigan, Missouri, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Texas, Tennessee, Virginia, Washington, Wisconsin, and Wyoming, and also Canada. I probably could have gone through a shorter list if I had read you the states that don't have it. Okay? But it's about 25% of the votes. So instead of a one, they can make it 1/2, or they can make it more than one. They can weight this through this reporting evidence. And this is very important because if the election is close, that's why we have to make sure that it is not even close. And we have some positive signs in that. As we're looking at this Hollywood Reporter story that was on the Drudge Report, how the anti-Hillary economy is exploding in merchandise and movies and in books, it shows that the people who are against Hillary are energized. We know we've had a record number of people show up to vote Republican, to vote for Trump. And Hillary Clinton's vote totals are way down from when she ran in 2008. And it has to be a landslide. You have to show up. It has to be a landslide. If it is close, like it is in North Carolina, if they rig it with the voter ID stuff, that's when she will win. Stay with us. We'll be right back with your phone calls. We're going to go to your phone calls here in just a moment. Patriot North Carolina wants to talk about voter ID because we just had this court case on Monday. The Obama administration was very excited about that. Two of the three judges who struck down the North Carolina law, who overruled the district court judge, Thomas Schroeder, a Fourth Circuit ruling. It was a 485-page decision back in April that upheld the law that was passed by North Carolina's representatives. But they don't like that. And you had Attorney General Loretta Lynch celebrating this ruling, shutting down North Carolina's law. She said this law was passed with discriminatory intent. She said it targeted African Americans with almost surgical precision, imposing stringent ID requirements, reducing same-day registration, and constraining out-of-precinct voting to place barriers between citizens and the ballot box. Look, these are the same people. And she goes on to say, the ability of Americans to have a voice in the direction of their country is fundamental to who we are. Okay, if you believe that, you wouldn't support the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is going to take away control of our economy, control of our laws, and put it in the hands of foreigners who are not citizens of this country in many cases who have never been here. They certainly don't live here, all right? You wouldn't support that. You wouldn't support the superdelegate system that you had. And if you really believed that IDs were racist, you wouldn't have used them at your Democrat National Convention, would you? Or everywhere else where you have an interaction with business or with government. And if it was targeting anybody, it was targeting the illegal aliens that you have brought in here that you now want to vote illegally. And, it's just absolutely amazing. And that's why Donald Trump said, hey, people can vote 10 times. Absolutely true. Here's an article from WorldNet Daily, and they're talking about California. This is back in May. This is an investigation that was done by CBS, KCAL Channel 9. They discovered hundreds of voters in Southern California who were dead, but still voting. In L.A. County alone, they had 215 vote from the grave. One guy passed away in Palmdale in 2003, John Sinkner. Yet records show that he was able to vote, even though he died in 2003. He voted in 2004, 2005, 2006, 2008, 2010. Another woman supposedly cast votes in 2014, 12, 10, and 8, even though she died in 6. Okay, she died not 6. So this is what we have here in the L.A. County Registrar. Says, well, we're taking out 1,200 to 2,000 deceased records from the database per month. Yet they found 212 of the 215 dead voters were still there. We're still voting, had been voting for many years. And as I've mentioned before, a close friend of my brother-in-law had this exact same thing happen to him. He went to North Carolina, where all you have to do is give him a name and an address. And they said, you've already voted. He said, that's not possible. And they said, yeah, another person at your address has already voted as well, your mother. And he goes, well, she's dead. Okay. He wouldn't come on and talk about it. He didn't want to be the person on there. That's why they said, hey, there's no incident of that happening in North Carolina, right? Here's another example, also from WorldNet Daily. This is James O'Keefe doing an undercover video. He goes to Michigan. So now I've talked about North Carolina. This other story that was done was in California, in L.A. Here's one in Michigan. James O'Keefe, the guy who does Project Veritas undercover videos, he goes in and he gives them a name of a well-known reporter, Brian Dickerson of the Detroit Free Press. And they say, he says, do I need a license? He says, I don't have my wallet with me. I lost it over the weekend hunting. My license fell out of my wallet. He says, I didn't know I need an ID. And so they said, oh, well, it's okay. Just sign this, fill it out front and back, sign the affidavit saying you are who you say you are and you can vote. And then he goes on and kind of he gives her the wrong name too. I forgot to say that. He said he lived on Marietta Street instead of Henrietta Street. Okay. She still gives him this affidavit, says, just fill this out. We'll be okay. And he says, I'm Detroit Free Press columnist Brian Dickerson. She appeared to be skeptical. She asks, you're not. You're Brian Dickerson? She says, so if you come in and vote as Brian Dickerson and another Brian Dickerson comes in, they can't vote. Are you his son? Says, nope, I'm the Brian Dickerson. She lets him do it anyway. She knows he's not Brian Dickerson. She lets him sign the affidavit, lets him vote. And that's the way this is going to roll. Let's talk to Patriot in North Carolina. Patriot, go ahead.
David, how you doing?
Doing good.
You're doing the state of North Carolina a great, great duty, my friend. Great state we live in, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
North Carolina.
Except when it comes to the government. I have some issues with what they do with the government. Go ahead.
I just wanted to tell everybody out there listening that North Carolina has a tremendous amount of illegal aliens in it.
Yes.
And I keep telling everybody that I think North Carolina may be a battleground state this year.
Oh, absolutely.
Simply because the it's so close, you know, it'd be so easy for them to rig the election. And I think that Donald Trump is trying to send out a subliminal message to everybody, especially in North Carolina. If you look up the voter laws, I think it's GS-163, any citizen, registered voter, can go in and actually watch them count the votes in the precinct at any level of the state vote counting. So if we're really going to get in there and catch the corruption and see any kind of fraud, we need to be there that night. And you can actually challenge a voter that goes into a vote that you think is illegal. You can go into the precinct judge, make a verbal complaint, and then go to the county board within the, you know, the 10-day period that they actually canvass the precinct.
I agree. And, yeah, there are some things that we can do with oversight. It's difficult, though, when you don't have to provide voter ID. And North Carolina is a battleground state. It is a key state. It is going to be one of those states that the winner is going to have to win. And right now, it is essentially tied. I mean, you got a margin of error of 3 or 4 or 5% on these polls. Right now, the latest polls show Clinton at 47.3% and Trump at 47.0%. There's 0.3% difference between them. And this is a time when they say, hey, we don't need to have any photo IDs. And, you know, they've got extended periods where people can come in and vote. And so that's what Trump is saying. Hey, people could go in and vote 10 times. Somebody voted at least 3 times with my friend, right? They voted their vote. They voted my friend's vote. And then they voted his mother's vote. So that's not far off of the mark that can happen there.
Similar story to that. Actually, the election of Obama and McCain, I was running late. Maybe 2 minutes before the precinct was supposed to close, I pull up. You know, I'm running. I want to vote. Hit the door. Bam. Locked. I knocked on it. And all the blinds are shut. Nobody knows what's going on in there. They could be doing anything inside of this precinct. People need to be there. They need to document.
That's right.
They need to get it up to the high level. Can I make one more comment about the constitutional election process?
Sure.
If I were Donald Trump, I would go ahead and tell the mainstream media right now that he's not going to concede the night of the election. It's actually the first week of January when the Electoral College meets, and people can really know for sure who got the nomination for president.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be so close this year that I know there are a lot of unbound electors that could go even against their own party. So would do us a justice as a republic to not give up, never, ever give up. Don't give up until they actually count the real vote.
And, you know, as what I've seen with the DNC, there are a lot of people, Democrats, who want fair and open elections as well. They didn't like the way this system was rigged by the DNC that was exposed. Well, we knew what was happening. But, you know, once you see the documents, once you see them talking about what they're going to do, that makes them very angry. And it is possible for someone who goes to the Electoral College to switch their votes. It actually happened with the Libertarian Party. You had Roger McBride, who was the producer for Little House on the Prairie. He actually was sent as a Republican elector, I think, from California. And he went to the Electoral College and voted for the Libertarian candidate. And, you know, that ends it as far as ever going back or ever doing anything with that party. But you can do that. And it was actually recorded. So if they get fed up enough with it, they could actually undo some of what happened. It remains to be seen if that's going to happen, though, because the people who typically do that are really party functionaries. Thank you so much, Patriot. Let's give some other people a chance to chime in. John in Minnesota. Go ahead, John. Oh, okay. He's gone. Chris in Georgia. Chris, go ahead.
Yes, hello. David, how are you doing?
Doing good.
All right. I think President Trump will win the election. Obama knows the people are too awake for him to cancel it. He knows Hillary will lose because he'll win the election in a landslide. But you and I know the polls are real. So my question is, do you think that people will fall for it and vote for her? Or avoid voting at all? Or do you think his supporters realize it and are not that dumb? And also, what if he is killed right after the elections? Do you think Pence will be able to take over as president? Because I don't know how that works since he won't be inaugurated yet.
Well, in terms of whether or not people are going to be fooled by what's going on. It remains to be seen. I think the vast majority of people are not fooled. I talked to a lot of people at the DNC who really didn't care what was revealed about Hillary Clinton. I mean, you know, she could do anything, and they would still say she's trustworthy, honest, and brave, and wise, and I'm going to vote for her. You can see the videos. Look at the people that I talked to. But there were also a lot of people that I talked to that were very angry about what had happened. And people who are issues-oriented. A lot of the Bernie supporters are that way. So I think that it's a mixed bag, and I think we're going to learn a lot more about Hillary Clinton. And we already know what's going on, but it's the releasing of the documents. And as I pointed out earlier in the program, we have William Binney saying, hey, the NSA has got this. We got 60,000 people in the intelligence community. They're upset. They're concerned. They're even concerned for their own safety. Any of those people could release that. You could have independent hackers who could release that information. The good news about Hillary Clinton is that she's not only crooked, but she's incompetent, okay? She can't protect her secrets. And it's very difficult even for competent people to protect stuff. We've seen massive hacks of all the federal employee databases. We've seen several hacks of the Federal Reserve where they went in and got the minutes where they're talking about whether they're going to raise interest rates or lower interest rates or whether they're going to increase or decrease the money supply. Information that could be used to play the market, to make money. So regardless of where you are, it's very easy for people to hack you. A determined person can get in there. And William Binney has actually said that. He said, hey, when I ask him, I say, you know, what can people do to protect their information? He goes, well, there's absolutely nothing you can do. If people are determined enough, they can get your electronic records. And that applies to people outside the government as well as inside the government. So I think there's a lot of things that are going to break with Hillary Clinton between now and then. A lot of people are very concerned about her criminality who are outside of the core of the Democrat Party. Even within the core of the Democrat Party, as I've mentioned, at the DNC, there are people who are concerned about Hillary Clinton. There are people on the outside, the periphery, who had walked out, delegates who had walked out, protesters who went there, who were furious about what had happened. And I think the vast majority of Americans are going to be amazed at what is documented about Hillary Clinton, without question, between now and the election. Also, she does not want to debate. Everything she does is carefully managed by her her organization. She hasn't, it's been over, 220 days, I think she's had a press conference. Everything that she does is carefully soundbite tested and controlled by the people who control her. So once she gets into a debate, it's going to be an interesting contest, isn't it? Because Donald Trump has some certain trigger things that he's pretty thin-skinned about. She's going to try to trigger those things, but she is also not somebody who wants to think on her feet. So the debates, I think, are going to be very interesting. Let's go to O'Brien in Maryland. O'Brien. Oh, okay. Lisa in New Jersey. Lisa, go ahead.
Hi, David. I was an eyewitness to voter fraud in Jersey City, New Jersey. I was a restaurant manager, and one Saturday afternoon, all of the local kids were coming into the restaurant to buy a milkshake. And they all had $5 bills, and they were all happy and thrilled. And I didn't say anything. I just was making the milkshakes and listening to their conversations.
Crisp new dollar bills, right? $5 bills. Sorry, go ahead. They're probably crisp new $5 bills as well, right? I'm just joking, but go ahead.
Yeah. All the kids, so I didn't say anything. And I just said to a couple of kids, like, where did you get that money? And the kids were like, oh, the people outside is handing them out. Handing out $5 bills. I said, for what? You just give them your name and address. And they sign you up to vote for Obama, and they give you $5. I was like, really? And there was one girl. She was 14 years old. She had a brand new baby in a baby carriage, a baby stroller. Baby was a couple of months old, maybe 2 months old. This was summertime. She had a $10 bill. Because they signed up the baby to vote. So one kid said to the other kid, I told them, I'm too young. I can't vote. And they said to the kid, don't worry, we'll vote for you.
Yes.
So
yes.
I didn't want the kids to see me calling the cops on my cell phone. I went into the kitchen and I called the police. The police came and they said, there's nothing we can do about it. The only thing we can do is ask them to move to the other side of the street because they were right in front of the restaurant in Jersey City. So I contacted the head of the Republican committee at that time in Hudson County. And he said the same thing. We can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
I said, they're buying the kids' names and addresses. They're going to go in. They're going to have people walk in off the street and vote under these kids' names. And even the new baby was going to vote. This was back in 2008, right before the election. The summer, right before the election.
Well, and of course, you've got jurisdictions where they say they're going to allow illegal aliens to vote. People can come here illegally. They don't have citizenship. They've disobeyed our laws to come in here, and they're going to let them vote. You've got several jurisdictions on the left and the right coast who are going to do that. They don't even care about people who are in the country illegally who are going to vote illegally. And that's why I said I think that's what the North Carolina voter ID law was focused on. There wasn't any sudden surge of black voters in North Carolina. There's a sudden surge of people coming into this country who are not American citizens who are doing that. But you're right. They get them registered on the rolls, and then they know who they can go in and say, I'm so-and-so, and they've got plenty of days to do it because they don't have everybody vote on one day. I mean, Lisa, you've seen how they conducted elections in Iraq, right? When they had the first elections, they had it on one day, and they had everybody come in. When you voted, they put an indelible ink on your thumb so you couldn't vote a second time. It's very simple. But the simplest tactics of having paper ballots that people watch from both sides, of identifying the voters, of having everybody vote on that same day, those things work. That's why the Democrats shut them down, because they want to rig these elections.
Yes. This is the biggest issue, voter fraud.
Yes.
Complete voter fraud.
Yes.
And I saw who did it. All right, David, have a great day.
All right, thank you so much. Let's go to Justin in New York. Justin, go ahead.
Hey, David.
Hey.
Hey, I was just I'm looking at this state-by-state requirement map of the voter ID laws, and I find it quite find it a little more coincidental that many of the largely blue states, such as California and my home state in New York, have no ID required to vote whatsoever.
Yeah.
But I was thinking, at least in terms of the electronic voting machines, where they're used, at least it seems like they could just make it so you had to authenticate, even if there's no ID required, you could authenticate yourself in some form or fashion, whether it's with the last four of your social, where you have to set up some sort of an account, like with a username.
I agree. We've got to go to break, and you're absolutely right. If they wanted to make electronic voting more secure, they could. They could have it set up so that you could validate looking secretly online to see how they recorded your vote. And you could do that with a lot of other people to do some kind of auditing, but they don't want that. They want to be... Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to try to get to as many calls as we can in this last segment of the show real quickly before we get back to our callers. I want to remind you that we have extended three products from our giant Sleeping Giant Mega Specials. We have 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and 30% off DNA Force. And that is a huge savings off of DNA Force. That is our premier product, and that is a big savings, 30% off of that. And we have store-wide free shipping. That's at InfoWarsStore.com. Those specials are not going to last much longer because we have to take care of our auto ship customers, but we extended it to 40% off Brain Force and 30% off both DNA Force and Vitamin Mineral Fusion, along with free shipping on everything else. Let's go back to our callers, Doug in North Carolina. Go ahead, Doug.
Well, certainly the two of us, you as a former North Carolina resident, myself as a current North Carolina resident. By the way, I live in the containment area for relocated Yankees, which I know will make you laugh because you know what that means.
Cary, North Carolina. Yeah.
Cary, North Carolina. Yeah.
Go ahead.
So you you certainly have been a resident of North Carolina within the last 5 years. So did you know that you can actually come back and vote?
Probably could, yeah. Generally, the country voting at various places, no problem, I guess.
Exactly. And, you know, this is what these conflicts are. And quite frankly, the last couple of callers, and certainly the lady that was talking about Jersey City, I'm not so convinced, David, that even the Republicans, while they passed this law for voter ID, I'm not so sure that they really want to change things all that much, because if that was the case, they would purge the voter list so that someone like you or someone like my weekend running buddy's sister, who has not lived here for the last 5 years, couldn't easily come back and vote in this state. And, you know, these conflicts, of course, one of the things about that law was that there was the motor voter registration. Well, then, okay, if that's the case, tell me that if you move into this state, the state requires you to register your vehicle within, I think, the first 3 to 6 months, because obviously they want the taxes. Well, that automatically makes you a resident of this state, which then makes you a non-resident of the previous state in which you lived. These are some of the conflicts that go on, not just here in North Carolina. But
well, you're absolutely right. If they wanted to change it, they could. And the Republicans do want to have this system propagated, just like they don't want to come after the criminal actions or the usurpations of power by Obama, because when they get a president in, they want to be able to run these executive orders themselves. They don't follow the Constitution, and they don't punish people who violate the laws, because they want to have that same access themselves. And so that's why they tolerate, on both parties, why they tolerate this type of corruption. You're absolutely right. I want to get to some of the other callers before we run out of time. Let's go to Edward in Arizona. Edward, go ahead.
Hey, David. Good to talk to you. Love all the products. Anthroplex, the Knockout, and the Brain Force. Yes. I take those all the time. But my main point was, this is a little bit off topic, although here in Arizona we do have voter ID. I love it. I feel very secure when I go in and vote. But I just wanted to get a message out to Alex, maybe through the Trump thing. He got 14 million votes in the primary. If we can get 11 million people to give $100, that's $1.1 billion. Maybe have a special T-shirt or something. I don't know. But then that would give him the mandate of the people, and the Bernie supporters would love that he's totally gets all his money from grassroots. And if we need to organize something where we encourage 11 million people. And then also I wanted Trump.
Only got about 5 seconds. Go ahead.
About NASA. I want to go to the moon. Enough of this climate change. Let's go.
All right. I agree. That's Edward in Arizona. Thank you, Edward. That's it for today's broadcast. Join us tonight for the nightly news, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.